Welcome to chapter 10 of the Introduction to Python and Programming course. This chapter finally talks about object orientation. In particular, we will talk about classes and instances. However, these are really technical terms that belong to the bigger paradigm of object orientation. So throughout the first 9 chapters, we have seen a lot of things in Python that basically also belong to object orientation, and this has a reason, because Python is, of course, an object-oriented language, and anything follows this paradigm. And so this chapter has many overarching themes. One of them is it will put together everything that we have talked about so far, and then it will also give us another big tool. So chapter 10 is finally the tool where we get the possibility to express in a semantic way what our programs do in code. So in other words, in this chapter, we will learn how we will give names and concepts from the real world to code, or in other words, how we model the real world in code in a way so that we can really say that's a good model of the world, and we can read it just as if you read some math that models some problem of the world. Okay, so because this chapter is about giving meaning to something, we have to specify a problem domain that we want to model, and I chose the problem domain of vectors and matrices. So this has several reasons. One of them is, of course, that this course is aiming at training you, preparing you for further course in data science. And besides good coding skills, what you also need to do to do data science is you also need to have good skills in math. And one of the disciplines within mathematics that is most important for data science is linear algebra. And because of that, I chose the domain of vectors and matrices from linear algebra as the example for chapter 10. And however, note that, of course, this is a programming course and not a math course, so I don't assume that you know too much about linear algebra. And I also don't assume that you will follow the linear algebra parts in this chapter. So I will focus on the bigger conceptual ideas of Python, of course, but the examples will be vectors and matrices. So if you want to fresh up your knowledge in math, there's a good opportunity on YouTube. It's this video course by Gilbert Strang from the MIT. He's a professor of math at MIT. And his course on linear algebra is one of the earliest, you know, courses that have been on the internet. And he's a very lovely guy. I met him once on campus at MIT, and he always has a smile, he's always upbeat. And he, even with his age of, I think, late 80s or something, he still is very enthusiastic of teaching young people math, and in particular linear algebra. And this online course that you just see here on YouTube is one of the most watched online courses ever. And Gilbert also has a very special way to connect to young people and a very nice sense of humor. So his course consists, as you can see, of 35 lectures, each of them roughly an hour. I can really recommend that to fresh up your knowledge on linear algebra. And then once you have done that, also an important note, anything that I talk about in this chapter, chapter 10, can also be done with a library called NumPy, and NumPy is the de facto standard. So if you want to implement any applications from the field of linear algebra in code, NumPy is probably one of the best choices to use. So in other words, what we are doing today here in chapter 10 is basically we start from scratch. We assume that NumPy has not been written, and we write our own little NumPy version. That's basically it. Okay, so let's look at an example. Assume you're given a vector y with the components 1, 2, and 3. How would you model that in Python? Let's say you don't know anything about NumPy, of course. If we already knew a little bit about NumPy, and we have seen that in chapter 9, then you would know that we would model that in NumPy with a so-called ND array. And towards the end of chapter 10, I would actually compare our own library here with NumPy. So we will see how to do that in NumPy. But now let's assume for a moment that NumPy doesn't exist. How would you model a vector with the components 1, 2, and 3 in Python code? Well, maybe you would do it like this. You would use a tuple, which we talked about in the first part of chapter 7. So here, a tuple 1, 2, 3 is assigned to the variable lowercase y. Maybe that is now our vector. Okay, we can look at it. It looks like a vector. It has nice round parentheses. So that's maybe why we choose to model that with a tuple. So here's another example, a matrix. A matrix consists of rows and columns. And this is a 3x3 matrix with the numbers from 1 through 9 arranged in a so-called row major way. That means when I say the numbers from 1 through 9, so the numbers, the first couple of numbers, the 1, 2, 3 make up the first row. So one convention in math is to look at matrices in a row first way, and we call that a row major way. The opposite, of course, would be a column major way to look at the matrix. And we already, you know, if we just look at core Python without NumPy, there are no two-dimensional data structures. So maybe one way to model a matrix would be to use a dictionary and, as the keys, use a tuple of two coordinates, so to say, one coordinate in the horizontal, the other going to the vertical axis here. And then maybe we use some coordinate system as the keys in a dictionary, and then the numbers that are displayed here as the values within the dictionary. That would be certainly one way to model a dictionary, a matrix in code. However, there is another way that we will choose. We will choose, for example, a list of lists. And because of the fact that matrices are two-dimensional structures and lists only model one dimension, we have to make an assumption here. So if I model a matrix with a list of lists, I have to assume that the inner lists are either columns or rows. So what should they be? Obviously, I chose the way where every inner list in the outer list here is a row of the matrix. And this is commonly what is chosen, and that is what I meant by the row major approach. But it would be certainly fine to do it the other way around. So we just have to remember that. Of course, if we accidentally switch the order, so we take this as the columns of the matrix, the inner list, then all we would have to do in matrix terms is we would have to transpose the matrix. We will also see how to do that in this chapter. But so if we don't know this convention, we will already have a problem, right? So sometimes, so that would be maybe something to document in the code. But let's now define x, uppercase x, so I don't adhere to the snake case here. And then uppercase x is, of course, the same thing as output. The literal notation remains the same. And now the thing is this. In math, in linear algebra, what we often do is we multiply a matrix by a vector to get a new vector. And again, the particular rules are not so important. Look at Gilbert Strang's course. The one rule that I will tell you here is that a matrix is seen as a a two-dimensional thing of rows and columns. And usually we refer to the rows as M and the columns as N. And then in order to multiply a matrix by a vector from the right-hand side, the number of components in the vector has to match the number of columns in the matrix. But in this case, of course, I chose a 3x3 square matrix. So it doesn't matter if we multiply the matrix by the vector y from the right or the left, both would work. However, also note that in linear algebra, If you multiply the matrix from the right-hand side, it is something different than multiplying it from the left-hand side. So we would get a different result if we multiplied the matrix from the left. But we will only do the standard way of multiplying from the right. And then, one way to get to the solution here is to see the outcome vector on the right-hand side as a linear combination of the columns from the matrix, where the weights for the individual columns are chosen from the vector by which we multiply. But again, the details, I don't want you to know. If you know it, it's good. You should know them if you want to stay in data science or go into data science. But if you don't know it by now, it's OK. So what do we do in code? Well, I want to multiply x by y. Let's do that. And I get a type error. And that makes sense, because how should Python know how to multiply a list of lists by a tuple? And that's exactly the point. I told you that we want to give semantic meaning to the code that we write, but a list of lists or a tuple has no semantic meaning. So Python doesn't know that we're talking about a matrix and a vector here, and it just looks at the operator, the multiplication here, and asks the left-hand side, the x, hey x, do you know how to multiply yourself with a tuple? And the x says, no, I don't know, I'm a list, I don't know how to multiply myself with a tuple. And then Python goes to the right-hand side and asks the tuple, hey tuple, do you know how you can multiply the list? And then the tuple says, no, I don't know. And if both operands don't know how to multiply the other, then the operator will say, well, type error, I don't know what to do. So, the storyline of this chapter is, at the end of chapter 10 here, we want to see x times y work. So that's the goal, fix the type error. How do we do that? So we have to teach Python, core Python, what a matrix is and what a vector is, and we also need to teach Python the rules of how to do matrix algebra. So the way to do that is with the so-called class statement. So we have to define a class, and then we have to what is called instantiate the class. So we will see that in code. So here is our first version of what a vector is. And also one note in this chapter, all the code cells, or many of the code cells, contain lots of code. There is no way you can read all of it. There is also no way I can discuss all of it. So it is absolutely necessary that you also work through chapter 10 and read it. And I think chapter 10 is, if you read it the first time around and watch this recording, then I think you should get a big picture. But it's definitely a chapter that you would have to read two or three times to get to it. But when you do the reading, you should certainly try to understand most of the code, because nothing that you will see in the chapter 10 or here on the slides is something that you don't know. All the constructs, all the syntax that you see here, you know already, or I just teach you the additional stuff you need to know to make this a class. So to do the I would just teach you the increment in this chapter to get from non-object-oriented programming to object-oriented programming. So let's look at this code cell and see and analyze what we see. The code cell starts with class and then a name, vector, and a colon. That's a typical header line. So all the rules that we know about header lines apply. In particular, they end with a colon, and everything below here is indented by 4. This is one level of indentation, and if I scroll down, this is valid until the end. So this is one statement. The entire code cell is one statement. It's a class statement. So what is the class statement? Basically, the class statement is very similar to the def statement, which defines functions. So we define something here. And then after we run the cell, Python has a name vector with an uppercase V, by the way, not a lowercase here, but we will get to the naming also. And then Python knows the name vector. And then whenever we say something about a vector to Python, then Python will always look up this code that we'll see. So in other words, what the class statement is, this is so-called namespace. So here is code, and this code is executed just like code within a function is executed when we call the function. However, there is one difference. The code within a function is only executed when we call the function. It is not really executed when we define the function. Of course, when we define the function, Python also reads the code and does something with it and puts it into the object in memory as so-called bytecode, but it doesn't execute the code. And here, that's one difference. So all the code that you see, when Python now reads this, when I now execute the code cell, then what Python will do is, Python will execute all the lines of code and will do exactly what is written here. And then the only thing you need to know about a class in this regard is it acts as a namespace. So remember when we ran functions when we call them, they were given a local scope where we would keep all the names that are local to the function as it runs. And once the function call is over and the function returns to where it was called from, then the local scope goes away. We've seen that in chapter 2 extensively, and we've also seen that with many, many other examples, right? So in, for example, chapter 4, when we looked at recursion and iteration, we also defined many, many functions, and whenever we executed them in, for example, Python Tutor, then we saw that every time we execute the function, we have the function has its own scope as long as it's running. And we also saw that several functions can be run at the same time and wait for each other and so on. So what I'm saying is Python will have many, many scopes at the same time and will by this way isolate many, many names from each other that could also be the same. But Python knows which name belongs to which namespace, and a class is nothing but such a namespace, wherein we have all the names. So, and then, how does this work? Well, when I now execute this code cell, all this code here is run, and then whatever the code does, the result of that will be stored in this new namespace. So let's run this from top to bottom in our head. So the first line of code sets a variable called dummy class variable to I am a vector. So after this statement is run, the class statement, inside the namespace that belongs to this vector class, we will have a variable called dummy class variable, which is set to this string here. Okay, and then we see three more statements, and it happens to be def statements. So it's ordinary functions, even though these functions, the names, they start with a double underscore and they end with a double underscore. And we call this the dunder convention, double underscore or short dunder convention. And in chapter 1, we already saw how Python uses those names that have a double underscore, a leading double underscore, and a trailing double underscore for variables that, you know, it uses in very special situations, or, you know, variables that are somewhat different from the variables we use. And now, in this chapter, whenever we define a function inside a class and the function's name starts and ends with a double underscore, we call this a so-called special method. And what a special method will do, we will see, but that's just a name. And no, you cannot just prepend any name, any function name with a double underscore, and then it's special. No, that's not the case. The names init, wrapper, and str that we see here on this slide, they are specialized. If you want to know where you will find them, so Python 3 data model, if that's what you should look for, and then in the Python documentation, in the docs, you will find, here it says, /reference/data model. And this page will give you all the possible names of all the possible special methods. So all the names are standardized, and you will find them here. We shouldn't care too much about this for now, But in the long run, if you study object orientation, this will be probably the number one page that you will look at to find out how something works. Okay, let's go back to the presentation. So what happens is Python runs this code and it creates one variable and three functions. And now let's analyze quickly what the functions do, and let's also see what is the rest in this class. So the class also starts with a doc string. That shouldn't surprise you by now. So this is the documentation of the class, and I just say this is a standard one-dimensional vector, and all entries are converted to floats. Okay, so that's the information we get. The dummy class variable I just put in there to show you in a moment. This is not so important for now, but the three methods, the three functions that we see, these are important. Whenever a function is defined within a class, we call it a method. And we saw already in chapter one that different data types in Python, so for example, the list type, the string type, and so on, they have different methods. And what are methods? These are different functionalities. For example, the string data type has methods like .lower or .upper. We saw that the float data type has a method called isInteger that looks at its contents, the contents of the object, of the float, and tells us if all the decimals are zero or not. That's its job. So different data types in Python come with different methods, different functionalities of different data types. And whenever we use the word data type or the type of an object, what we really look at is how does the object behave? That's the question we have in mind. And the special methods here, these are the things that will make a custom object, that's what a class at the end of the day is, a custom data type, a vector here, behave in a certain way. So this is how we teach Python how to look at an object of this type in a way that it knows how, for example, to do the linear algebra rules and so on. So, long story short, there is the first function called init, and init is the initializer. This function will be called every time when we create a new vector. So this vector class is basically a general blueprint of vectors in general. And then whenever we create a concrete vector out of the blueprint, then this function will be executed, the init function. That's why it's called initializer. And this function takes two arguments. The first one is self, the second one is data. And then we see that the two other special methods down here, they also take one argument called self. So what is self? So self is a convention. This is the name self is by convention given to the first argument or to the first parameter of a function that becomes a method in a class. And whenever this function is called, the first argument that is passed to it will be the object on which we call the method. Okay, so in other words, to give you an example that you're familiar with, you have a string object. The string object could be, you know, my first name, whatever, any name that is in a text string, and you call .lower on it, and then somewhere in Python's source code, some method called lower will be called, which is a function. And the function will get one argument passed to it, which is the text string on which we called the function. That's why it's self. So whenever we have a concrete example of a vector and do something with it, the first argument to any of these functions will be the vector object itself. That's why by convention we call it self. And then we have a second parameter called data. And the data is actually documented in the doc string of this function, of the init function. And data is, as we see, any iterable. And it says the vector's entries must have at least one element. Yeah, it doesn't make sense to have a vector that has no component. I mean, a mathematician would probably disagree, but we as pragmatic programmers, we don't want vectors that have nothing in them. And then I should have written here, which I haven't, but I should have, that the iterables should also be finite. So these are the two properties of sequences that we look at, the iterable property and the size property. And this is really all we need to create a vector. So we need a sequence that is finite, so we can iterate over it. And actually, I mean, only the iterable is needed here, but maybe we should also put somewhere in the documentation that the iterable be better ordered. Why? Well, if you create a vector from the numbers 1 to 3, you want the resulting vector to be 1 to 3 and not in another order. So, but, you know, long story short here, data can be anything. It should be iterable, so it will most likely be a tuple or a list. And we saw that earlier when we modeled the vector, we used a tuple. So probably we'll just use the tuple to pass it as data. And then inside the init method, what happens is self, again, is the object itself. It's the concrete vector that gets created. It already exists at this point. And then what we do is we loop over data one by one. And data is the source of data, the source of numbers we want to put in the vector. And then for every number in this data argument, we call float. So we cast it as floats. And that's actually what the doc string up here says. This will be a vector that only holds floats. And then we put this in a list. Okay, so what this is, that's it, the list constructor. And inside it, we have a so-called generator expression, which we saw extensively in the second part of chapter 7. And why do we use a generate expression here? Well, I use generate expressions in this chapter basically anywhere, so that working with the vectors and matrices that we design here is memory efficient. I don't want to have temporary lists and tuples and so on floating around in memory that only get created once and then stored away somewhere and then get forgotten or something. I just want to do all the operations in this chapter on a one-by-one basis. That's why I use generator expressions everywhere here. But then once the vector gets created, I have to physically store all the numbers in the vector, and I do so in a list. And then the list, where's the list stored? The list is stored on the vector, so on self, under an attribute called entries with a leading underscore. And the leading underscore in variable names means that the user of this code, so whoever will use the vector class to create vectors later, should not use it. So in other words, whenever we have a leading underscore on an attribute name, that is on some object within, so in other words, within some class definition, then this is a so-called implementation detail. We don't care, you know, from later on when we use the vector, we don't really care how the numbers are how the numbers are stored. They can be stored in a tuple, or in a list, or somehow else. We don't care. All we care about is we want to use the vector as such. And you know how the data is stored, this is up to the person that wrote the definition, which is in this case also us. But maybe we are writing this vector definition, this vector class, for someone else, and the other person will only use the vector and not modify the source code here. So this is basically only meant for us to be used internally here. And then I do some other stuff. Again, I'm not going over all the code. I'm just giving you the big ideas, and then you will understand it better if you when you read it later on. Okay, and then wrapper and stir. For now, I will come back to that. Let's just see. Let's define the class. And now let's see what can we do with the class. So I have run the cell. Note, I have executed this. And then, as I said, vector now exists. So what happened is, in memory, we have, I draw this a bigger here. So let's do this. Maybe a little bit zoom out. So, and this, of course, will have a type, but we don't know it yet. And here I have the name uppercase vector, and this will be a reference here. Okay, and this will be our blueprint, okay? So we will fill this in slowly over time. So How do I know that this must be an object? Well, it has a address, so it has an identity. That means this box must exist. Now it has a type. What's the type of vector? It's of type type. Okay, so I can put in here type. So where have we seen this? Where have we seen that the type of something, of some object, is type? We have seen this in chapter 2 when we talked about callables. And we talked about built-in functions, but then there were built-in functions like sum and len and so on. But then there were other built-ins that we used. And which one am I talking about? I'm talking about the built-in constructors. So the int constructor, float constructor, string constructor, and so on. When we asked type of this, we would get also type. So actually, we can try it out. So as I said, what is the type of int? The type of int would be type. This is actually what we saw in chapter 2. And this is how we differentiated the built-in constructors from built-in functions. So whenever something is of type type, now I can solve the puzzle. Whenever something is of type type, what this means is it's a blueprint. So it's basically a blueprint that is used every time we create a new vector. So every vector we will create will follow the same blueprint. In other words, every concrete vector, no matter how many numbers are in there, will follow the same mathematical rules that we only define once. Okay, so in other words, this blueprint, the type here, gives us the opportunity to write code only once and reuse it. It's kind of like a function in that way. It's a generalization of functions. It's a way to organize code, and we do that. And it's not only a way to organize code, it's also a way to give semantic meaning to the code. So here the blueprint has the name vector, so we know exactly what the blueprint means. So let's go on. And now what happens if I evaluate vector? Well, it just says main. Main is the file we are in. So whenever you are open a command line and you are not in some, you don't switch the directory or you don't import something or whatever, then you're always in the main directory, so to say. And this is what we have here. That's what main means, but we can actually ignore main. It's not so important. And then vector is just vector. And we know that this is a so-called literal notation oftentimes. So let's just try. And actually, main is not defined, okay. But it's okay. So vector is at least defined. So vector in this sense is a literal. So now what can we do with vector? So first of all, remember the dummy class variable. So the dummy class variable can be accessed with the dot operator. So vector.dummy class variable will give us I'm a vector. So in other words, I have, for example, a dummy class variable here. And this is something that, in this case, points to some object of type str. And this has in it I am a vector. So in other words, I use the dot notation to follow the references. We have seen this before when we imported the modules, third-party stuff, and so on in chapter 2 first, but then also several other times. Okay, what else can vector do? So can we actually access init? Yes, we can. And what is init? As I told you, init is just a common function. So in other words, the name vector with an uppercase V acts as if it is a namespace. We have stuff in it. We have functions in it, and we have variables in it. And I can access the functions and the variables by going via the vector variable. So I say vector dot, and this is how I get here. So in Python Tutor, whenever we called a function, the function's global scope was actually always some area that belonged to the function call that was kept here, right? And now the namespace, so to say, is this thing here. But it's still a namespace. And a namespace is nothing but a list of names that point somewhere. And that's the global namespace, and this is the class namespace. Okay. And then somehow magically, some names appear. So for example, the vector class has a variable called underscore underscore name underscore underscore. So we call that dunder name. Double underscore is abbreviated as dunder. And in this case, we say dunder name. Okay. And Python does that, a lot of times. So it often, creates something in the background that follows, something we do. And whenever you create a vector or whenever you execute a class statement, then the class will have a name, at least most of the classes, and the name will also be stored on the class. Okay, and now I want to create a new vector, a concrete vector. So now note this is the blueprint, and the blueprint does not contain any numbers. Now I want to create the vector 1, 2, 3. How do I do that? By passing an iterable, this is data now, the iterable containing 1, 2, 3, to the vector class. So in other words, what I do here is I call the vector class. Vector, and then the call operator. So this looks like a function. The only thing that tells me by convention that this is not a function is the fact that it's uppercase. And that's a convention. Classes, they are usually written with uppercase camel case. That's the convention. That means we start with a uppercase letter here. And functions would be snake case, so lowercase. And that's. But at the end of the day, I can call a function with the call operator, but I can also call a class with the call operator. And I pass it one argument, which is a list. Now, just to make this clear, we modeled a vector with a tuple, and that was just arbitrary. We could have modeled a vector also with a list, but now let's use a tuple. So I will now pass in a tuple, the tuple 1, 2, 3, as the first and only argument to the vector class. And whatever I get back, I store in V. So let's do that. And now let's look at V. What is V? So I called the vector class. And what then happened is the init method was called. And the init method, we remember, had two parameters, self and data. However, when I called vector, I only passed in one. That's important. I only passed in data because I already told you that the self argument or the self parameter will always be filled in with a reference to the object. So where's the object? Okay. What happens is when I call vector, Python is smart enough and creates a new box. And the box will have a type, of course. I don't have it yet. But what we do is the vector, when I call it, it creates a new object. And the object is stored as V. So whatever this object is, the lowercase v is referencing it. Okay. So this is what happened when we called vector. We call vector. And then the init method in the vector class will be executed. The first argument that is given to the init class, to the init method, will be the reference to this object, because that's the new object. This is self now. This is the concrete object that is about to be created from the vector class. And then the second argument passed to the init is data. So, and what happens? This init method initializes this new object that was created. And then once the initialization is done, the object exists in memory and has the name V referencing it. And how can we see that V must be an object? Well, of course, here V has an ID. So this is the address, the identity. And now V also has a type. What's the type of V? Well, the type is vector. So the type is now uppercase vector. And now uppercase vector is the same variable name as the name variables, the name vector that references the class, the blueprint. But now this new object is of type vector, okay? And on objects, we have a dunder class attribute, and the dunder class attribute also has vector. So type of V and V dot dunder class is actually the same. So this is a synonym. This is also a name that Python creates for us automatically. And then, what can I do with lowercase v? Well, I can now put it in a cell on its own and evaluate the cell. So I will now evaluate v, and I get back vector, parentheses, parentheses, 1, 2, 3 as floats, parentheses, parentheses. Looks almost like up here, just up here, the data argument only had has integers. But if I go back to the init method, how it was defined, that was one too much. The init method, how it was defined, we had this generator expression where we looped over all the elements in data, which is in this case a tuple we passed in, and we called the float construct for every number in it. That means every integer that was in data, in the argument here, will become a float. Now the question is, how does, or why does Python give us back such a nicely formatted representation of the vector? Well, first of all, whenever a vector or whenever a representation of an object, of any object, can be copy-pasted back into the code cell and executed, and it works, we call that a literal, right? However, this is not a literal. So that's now what we will call the text representation of an object. So every time I copy-paste now this back, and every time I now execute this code cell, what happens is a new object of type vector will be created with the same numbers in it, the same components. So in other words, just as the literal notation of any built-in allows us to create a new object with the same value as the object whose literal value we are copy-pasting, in the same way, I can copy-paste the text representation of any object, for example, v. I can copy-paste v's text representation back into a cell, and what will happen is I get a new object with the same value. So basically, conceptually, nothing new happens. The same thing that happens for built-ins also happens here. Now the question is, why is it so nicely formatted? Does Python do that automatically? And the answer is, of course, no. We had to teach Python. Where did we teach Python to give us such a nice text representation? Well, it's, of course, a special method, and it's this one here, the so-called wrapper method, or Danda wrapper. And wrapper is the abbreviation for representation. And by definition, if you, let me see, if you went back to the data model page here in the documentation, and if we read through it, then there is a convention defined. And this convention basically states that the text representation of any object should be a string, so a built-in string type, a string that, when copy-pasted back into a code cell, gives me a new object with the same value. That's the definition of the text representation. And now by now we know what is a string. Well, a string, as we saw in chapter 6, is nothing but bytes, and bytes are just sequences of 8 bits. And the bytes are encoded into code numbers. So every bit and every group of bits, or every byte, at the end of the day translates into an integer, as we saw in chapter 5. And then if we decode the bytes, we get a Unicode character, which we saw in chapter 6. And the definition and or the idea of the text representation is that we have Unicode text that we can just copy-paste and get the value back in a new object. So that's the idea of text representation. So in other words, this is the output we will see in code cells that we see for built-ins as well. But now, because we don't have a built-in data type, we have to create this on our own. And also note, there is a string special method, Dunder string. These two are very similar. However, the Danda wrapper method is there to create a text representation primarily for computers. So another computer, another machine, can get exactly the text that represents the vector in this case, and you know, decode the text into bytes and so on, and will basically create an object similar to the one, or exactly the same actually to the one that we are reading. And then, so the wrapper is basically a more technical thing of representing an object. And then we have Danda string, and then the string has only one purpose, and it is to create a representation, a text representation, that we as humans want to see. Okay, so whenever we use, and I will just shortly show you how this works, whenever we use, for example, the print function and give it our object here, the vector object, then we want a nice representation of the vector so that we as the human know what the vector is. And that's why we have two different representations here. One is called wrapper, the other is called stir, or Danda wrapper, Danda stir. And so both of them return, as we can see, a string. So we have a format, an F string here. Both of them return a string. And the first string is to be consumed by a machine. And the second string, this one is for us. It's the debug output, so to say. Let's see what that means. Since we have a vector, the vector v, again, if I just evaluate the vector in a code cell, I get back the text representation, the Danda wrapper result. But now I can explicitly call Python's wrapper built-in function. So I can call wrapper and give it v, and I also get it back. But now note how now I have here the quotation marks. So this is now a text string. And if I go back, here I don't have the quotation marks. So this is to be, so the difference is, because I don't have the quotation marks, this I can copy paste back into the code cell and generate a new object with the same value. And because here I have the quotation marks, I could also copy paste this back, but then I just get a text string with the value. So this is a little bit different, but don't get confused here. It basically returns the same thing. Just the one thing returns it as a literal, and the wrapper explicitly returns it as a string object. And then there is stir, the string constructor that we saw in chapter 6. And we can also call the string constructor with the v as the argument. And then we get now the nice representation for us humans. So the difference is the first text representation, the wrapper, we want to be able to copy paste it back in to get the same object back. And the result of a string, we don't want to copy paste it back. What we want is we want to get a, I would call it a summary, so that we as the human know what the vector is. And I built this Danda stir method such that it gives us back only the first component and the last component, because this vector could be very big. It could contain thousands of numbers, and I don't want, and if a vector contains thousands of numbers, this would also contain thousands of numbers and would be very long, but we need all the numbers. Otherwise, we couldn't copy paste it back in the command line and get it back. And so the second there, that's for us as humans, and we don't really care about the individual numbers, but what we care about is how many numbers there are. That's what the brackets 3 means. So that means the vector has just 3 components in it. Okay, so we have seen now 3 special methods. The most important one was the init. The init is the one that does the initialization. And also, note how, if I go back, there was, for example, also a input validation here. So I say, if the passed in data does not contain any elements, so if the length of the list is 0, then we raise a value error and say the vector must have at least one entry. So we do, so the initialization, the init method, not only takes the arguments and stores them on the self object, on the vector itself, but it also does some input validation. And let's see this at work. So let's see where we put it, maybe here. So here I create a good vector, but let's say I now create a vector and I pass in, let's say, an empty list. So I try to create a vector that does not have any components inside. And what happens if I execute this, I get a value error. And it says the vector must have at least one entry. And it's exactly the value error I just showed you. So this is why the init method is so important. The init method gets the arguments that we want to collect in order to create a new object. And then it verifies that the object is, you know, can be created. So the argument that we passed in is good. And our assumption was the vector should have at least one component. And then it creates the vector. And that's what init does. So this is really important method. And then we have seen two other examples of special methods now, the wrapper and the stir. They are not so important, actually. But I just want to show you how things, some built-in functions, translate to what's going on with an object. So the stir built-in, for example, when I called it, basically just forwarded the call onto this dunder stir method on the object. Okay. Okay, maybe let's get rid of this again here. And let's go on. So now we've understood the basics of the basics of class definition. And I will subsequently fill in here the blueprint and also the example as well, so that you see that what goes on in memory here. So now we do the same thing for a matrix. We have now taught Python a early implementation of what a vector is, and now we do the same thing for a matrix. So we use the class statement to create a new blueprint. So at the end of the day, when I execute this, what this will do is, this will, let me zoom out a bit, this will create another blueprint. And we also know already that this must be of type, because it's a blueprint. And then let's see what is in there. Definitely we will have an init special method. And what I don't do now is, because this wouldn't, you know, this the diagram, the space wouldn't be enough. Of course, there is a function object somewhere, and we have a reference from the init to this function object, right? So this is just an ordinary function, the init method. And I don't do this here, what I did for the string here. I don't put references everywhere. Just assume that everything that I put in the blueprint also has a reference to some object, because everything in Python is an object. And so we just I just have a more simplistic way of showing this to you. And now let's quickly analyze what is how does the matrix work. So a matrix is initialized also from data. And now the thing is this: we have to now assume if we pass in the rows or the columns first. And so let's read the documentation. So it says data is supposed to be an iterable of iterables, the matrix entries, and must be provided with rows first. The number of columns must be consistent across rows. Okay, that means every row has to have the same number of columns, or every column has to have the same number of rows. In other words, I must not forget an entry to the matrix. And then also, all the entries are also converted to floats. So how do we do that? Well, I have here a nested list comprehension, a nested generator expression in here. So I have here, I have an inner expression, which is a list. And I have here a generator expression. And then the whole thing is another generator expression. So I'm now nesting the generator expressions. And this is just to be memory efficient, but you don't have to really understand everything here. That's OK. And then what we do is we do some input validation. And I'm not going over this, but what this ensures is that basically I cannot create a matrix with no entry. And also all the rows have to be have to have the same number of columns. And then we have a wrapper and a stir special method who do the nice text representations. And that's it. So let's see. What is matrix? Matrix is an object. It's of type. That's what I put here. So it's also a blueprint. And it goes by the name matrix. So now the matrix name points here. So what can we do? Now I can create a matrix. So let's create a matrix M. And the matrix consists of three rows with the numbers 1 through 9. So I have here the first parenthesis is again the call operator. I'm calling the matrix blueprint to create a new object, a new matrix object. And then I have one iterable, which I represent with the brackets here. And then also the iterable, the list, contains three tuples, and every tuple contains three elements. And let's see if that works. It does. And now what is M? M is an object of type matrix. And it's a matrix, and we see it has also a nice text representation. And don't be confused that we only have parentheses here, we didn't here. This text representation, as you will see, is intentionally built this way. So also see that, for example, we always have a trailing comma for technical reasons here. It's not so easy to build such a thing, so you will read it up in the source code when you read when you do the reading. But at the end of the day, if you copy paste this back, this would create a new matrix with the same elements in it. And it doesn't matter, because when we designed the init method inside the matrix, so we just said we want data to be an iterable of iterables. We don't care if it's a list of tuples or a list of lists or a tuple of lists. We don't care. It must be an iterable of iterables, and that's what we have here. And that's also what the output down here shows. So what do we have here? We have, again, a new object, and this object is now of type matrix, and we will have something in it, and this goes by the name M. So that's the situation. And maybe to make this a little bit nicer, so what matrix means, the matrix type means, whenever we work with V or M, then Python will go ahead and look up the type and then go to the blueprint, and the blueprint will tell Python how these objects should behave. Okay, so that's the whole story. And then we can, of course, have as many objects, as many vector objects and as many matrix objects as we want, and they all behave in the same way. They all work after the, they all have, you know, they work like the blueprint says. Okay. So so far so good. And now let's start with putting many more special methods inside our two blueprints, and then to slowly over time make sure that the V and the M object behave just like vectors and matrices. And then at the end of the lecture, we will be able to multiply M by V. That's the whole point. So let's talk about another topic here, so-called computed properties. So what are computed properties? Well, let's look at the example of a matrix. So when I created a matrix, for example, this matrix here, M, the matrix consists of 9 elements arranged in 3 rows and 3 columns. So if I asked you, what's the dimension of the matrix, you would tell me that's a 3x3 matrix. And if I told you that, no, that's a, I don't know, a 5x7 matrix, then you would say, no, there are only 9 elements, and they are, you know, arranged in 3 rows and 3 columns. So what I'm saying is, just by the fact that the 9 numbers are arranged in the way they are, we have derived properties. The matrix has a derived property, which is the dimension. So the property is kind of like dependent on the state or on the data that is in the matrix. So when I want to ask the matrix, hey, how many rows do you have? This is not something we can make up. This is something that we just look at the numbers that the matrix is storing, and then we know the answer. So how do we do that? We take here, again, a new version of the matrix class. So throughout this chapter, whenever I show you a new definition, a new class definition of a matrix or vector, I will often leave something out that we've seen before just to keep it at least a little bit short. And then finally, at the end of the chapter, I will show you the full picture of the matrix and the vector class. So what's new here? The two new things here are the properties. So what are properties? So these are attributes that get calculated. And how do they get calculated? Well, the blueprint does the following. The blueprint takes as the argument the concrete matrix in this case that stores the data, and then looks at the data, and then calculates the attribute, in this case, n rows and n calls, and returns that for the object. Okay, so maybe just to finish the diagram here, maybe let's have here the list 1, 2, 3, and here let's have a list of list. Just draw in the numbers. Second list, 4, 5, 6, and another list, 7, 8, 9. So just to show you that the actual data of the vector in the matrix, they are in these objects, of course, right? They are not in the blueprint. But now, if I want to know how many rows and columns I have, what we do is we will define a function here in the blueprint that, when executed, is given the concrete object as the self argument, and then the blueprint will look at the list of lists that is stored internally on the object in the hidden property entries, and then just do some counting and give us back the what we're looking for. So in other words, what does nRows do? nRows just takes the hidden list, and we know that the hidden list in entries is a list of lists, and every inner list is a row. So in other words, if I want to know the number of rows, I just have to take the length of the outer list. That's it. And if I want to calculate the number of columns, I have to index into the list, into this outer list here, to get to any of the inner lists. And each of the inner lists is basically resembles a row. And then if I take length function of the inner list, of one of the three inner lists here, I get 3 back, because all the rows are guaranteed to have the same length. That's what our initializer did. So in other words, we're just looking at the first inner list, and this is the number of columns, right? So we have two functions. However, we don't want to call a function here. So we don't, when we use V and M, or in this case M in particular, I don't want to say M dot n rows call operator. I just want to say m dot n underscore rows. And what this Python built-in property does, it basically makes Python call this method when we don't call it. Okay, so let's first write here. We have an attribute n rows, and we have a second attribute n calls. Let's define the function and just see an example. So here's my new m. And now, so here's m. I created the matrix m, and here it is. Here's m. And the matrix consists of 2 rows with 3 elements each. And so now if I call dot n rows on m, then the function we just saw gets executed. And if I call dot n calls on m, then the nCalls function in the blueprint gets executed. But I don't want to write here a call operator, and that's why we write property. And the property then makes Python call the function, okay? So now, in other words, conceptually speaking, I create a matrix with 6 numbers arranged in 2 rows. And because of that, the matrix has derived properties. The number of rows is 2, and the number of columns is 3, right? And then, of course, because this is a derived property, we cannot set it. We cannot just claim that the number of rows is 3. So what do I mean by that? I cannot try to set the number of rows to 3. Let's do that. I get a so-called attribute error. I can't set the attribute. In other words, this property, or these properties, they are read-only, and that makes sense. In this context, it makes sense. There are ways to make properties writable. However, let's say if I have a matrix, a 3x3 matrix, and I tell the matrix, hey, your number of rows should be 2, what should the matrix do? It actually would have to get rid of the last row, right? So in other words, we could see a situation where we allow the matrix to set the number of rows and the number of columns. But then, if we allow the user of this class to do that, then we would have to have some logic that would basically throw out some of the data in the matrix. And also note that if I have a 3x3 matrix and I try to set number of rows to 10, what should we do? Should we make up data then? So in other words, what I'm saying is it's really not a good idea to make this property readable. But there are ways in Python to make properties readable, writable, I mean. And so this is read-only. But in the given context, it absolutely makes sense. Okay, these are derived properties. Now let's continue a little bit. So now the next topic is instance methods versus class methods. So let's see an example, then it becomes easy. So let's first look at this new version of Matrix. And now I want to shift your focus on the transpose function. So what is transpose? Every matrix, once it exists, can be transposed. Transposition of a matrix means we flip the rows and the columns. So how do we do that? Or actually, what does that imply? Transposing is an operation that is always attached to a concrete matrix. I cannot transpose a matrix that doesn't exist yet. I always have to look at a concrete matrix in order to transpose it, which is why transpose takes an argument self, right? So whenever I transpose a matrix, whenever I ask the blueprint, hey, transpose something, the blueprint will say, give me the matrix I should transpose. And then we just give it a concrete matrix here, for example, M. And then when we call the function here, the transpose function in the blueprint, then self will be set to M automatically. So whenever we call a method, as we shall see, we don't have to specify self on its own. And then what the transpose method does, it references the matrix class itself and calls it. So now it calls matrix itself and passes some argument to it. We don't want to understand what is really going on. This is the magic that you should read at home try to figure out otherwise. But what it conceptually does is, and that makes sense, when we transpose a matrix, in this case, we get back a new matrix. So matrix gets called again with other data. And what the SIP and the unpacking self-entries does, it basically flips the rows and the columns. But it's not so easy to see why it does that. But in other words, the transpose method will give us back a new matrix. So it returns a new matrix object here. Okay. So let's first see how this works. Let's create a new matrix. I always have to create a new matrix because whenever I update the blueprint, what really happens in Python is I get a new blueprint somewhere else. And because of that, because the objects are attached to the particular blueprint, I also have to create a new object which is attached to the new blueprint, right? That's why we always have to keep recreating the M's and the V's. So what is M now? M is just the matrix as we created it, two rows, the 2x3 matrix. And now I want to transpose it. So how do I do that? Well, now that we defined the transpose method in the matrix blueprint, we can now go ahead and call the transpose method on every matrix object, which is here. And that's it. And then, as I just said, the transpose function inside the matrix class takes its first argument as self. But whenever we read the first argument as self, we can assume that Python automatically gives in the reference to this object here, right? This is basically true for any function you create inside a class. The first argument is always automatically filled in with a reference of the object to the object on which we call the method, right? This is also true for init. So init or all these special methods are no different than any of the other methods, the non-special methods. But again, the method always works with concrete data, with a concrete matrix. So let's do it. Let's call m.transpose. And what do I get back? I get back a new matrix, which has now three rows consisting of two columns. And the first column, 1, 4, now is the first row, 1, 4. So it seems to work. And of course, we know if I take the matrix, the transpose twice, I should end up with the same matrix, right? So let's do that. Let's verify if that works. So I call m dot transpose and then call operator, because methods have to be called. It's not like properties. And then I say dot transpose again. And this is an example of method chaining. That's what it's called. So because, and that's something that we have to implement on our own, because calling transpose on M returns a matrix, we can, on the new matrix, call transpose again a second time, and the third time, and the fourth time. This is called method chaining. And the nice thing about method chaining is that it reads like it reads really nice in English, basically. So I have a matrix and I transpose it twice. What get I back? I get back a new matrix n, and then we know that n should be like the original matrix, right? And we see that the n now is a 2x3 matrix and looks just like m. One problem, or let's first verify that m and n are two different objects. So we use the identity operator. Is, and indeed, M, the matrix we created, and its transpose N are two different objects, which means when we call dot transpose here, a new object gets created, and we call dot transpose on it again, and another new object gets created, and then this one would be stored as N. This is basically what we did. I'm not drawing it here to save some space, but we would actually end up with one intermediate matrix that gets lost, and a second matrix that gets stored with the variable n, and then we are ending then we end up with two matrices that have the same data inside them. However, the n here, if I use the comparison operator for m and n unfortunately don't evaluate equal, and that means the comparison operator does not work, and there's a reason for that. How in the world should Python know how it should compare two objects of our new custom data type? Because we haven't taught Python yet. We will, of course, do so later on. But for now, comparison does not work. Okay, this is a method, a so-called instance method. And then we contrast this with a so-called class method. So, at the end of the day, everything we see in this memory diagram, in the memory part, is an object. So the class is an object, and this class is an object. And then what are these objects? Well, these objects are objects of type vector and objects of type matrix, but they are also objects. Everything is an object in Python, meaning identity, type, and value. However, we see that by the green arrow, which are true here, that the blueprints, the classes, and these objects, so these objects and the upper two objects, they have a special relationship to each other. And how we call this relationship is, we say when the matrix, so we call this here the class, the blueprint, and the concrete object we refer to as the instance, right? So that's the behavior. So an instance is just a concrete example or a concrete version of the blueprint, and the blueprint is called class. But we use these terms, class and instance, to refer to the role that the objects have with each other, the relationship they have with each other. But at the end of the day, they are all objects. So object-wise, they are, you know, the same, but they have a certain relationship, and the relationship is that of this object is the class for this instance. And of course, it's the same up here. So, and whenever now we do something with the concrete instance, we usually refer to that in this case as an instance method. So transpose is an instance method. Why? Because the function transpose, when executed, it needs a concrete instance to work. And the concrete instance is called self. And I told you that we don't have to pass it in explicitly because Python does it for us. So Python by default assumes that whenever we call a function in the class blueprint, that it is a instance method, and that the first argument is the concrete instance on which we call the function. However, there is a second type of methods, which is called a class method. And a class method works like this. We specify it just as we specify any other function within the class. And then we use this add operator and just write class method. That's a built-in by Python, just like property. And now the first argument, the first parameter of this function, by convention, does not be called self. It is called CLS, which is the short form for class. We cannot write class because class is a keyword that we cannot use. So we abbreviate it with CLS for class. So just as self gets filled in when called with a reference to a concrete object, CLS, when called, gets filled in with a reference to the class itself. That's why we call it a class method. So what are class methods good for? Class methods, one good use case for class methods is to provide a so-called alternative constructor. So what is a constructor? So look at init up here. Init is what gets executed whenever I call the matrix class. So matrix, and here I have a call operator. Whenever I call the matrix class, whatever I pass in here is put through the init special method, the initializer. Now, in this particular example, we assumed that the data argument to the initializer is provided in a row major way, so as a list of lists, and the inner lists are rows. And I just said we, you know, basically just made that up. We could also do it the other way around. And that's exactly what we do down here. We define a function called fromColumns, which is also given data, but data is also an iterable of iterables. However, here the inner lists are supposed not the rows, but supposed to be the columns. So in other words, the role that this fromColumns function down here takes is the same as the initializer, just that it basically has to transpose the data. So in other words, what we do here is we know that whenever we create a function, an object of class matrix in this case, and we give it data, then we assume that it's a row first. But then whenever we just, whatever matrix we get back, if we transpose it, then we know it's column first. So that's the trick here. So basically, this allows us to create a new matrix by passing it in the data in a column first way. And then we also look at this. Up here, matrix is called, and we use matrix as a variable. So the class statement creates, as we saw, a variable called matrix. This is the one that we have in the list of all names. And we can always just call matrix the name, but we don't just have one reference to the class. In particular, as I told you, that this class method thing here ensures that the first argument to the fromColumns function is a reference to the class. That is why the CLS variable here is also a reference to this particular box here, to this particular object. In other words, I can call CLS as well. CLS and calling it with data is exactly the same as calling matrix, right? However, what I do here is I hard code, so to say, the name in here. It references itself. We see that it's obviously possible, but it's not not so good for some other reasons that you will see when you read the chapter. In particular, when you get to the spot where we talk about inheritance late at the end of the chapter. And so we prefer to also parameterize the class here. But it's not so important. You could also just write matrix, also works. So now, what does fromColumns do? As I said, it works as an alternative constructor. So let's construct a new matrix by giving it the data in a column first way. So here I just have the transpose data, and I don't call matrix, but I call the from columns class method on the matrix class. So I write matrix.fromColumns, and I pass in the data in a column first way, and I store the result as M. And now if I look at M, the matrix is of course the same as before. So the matrix, the text representation of a matrix is always row first. That's how we designed the matrix, but now we have an alternative constructor. That's the role that class methods often play. But syntactically, just to reiterate the point of this section, whenever we have a function inside a class definition, the first argument will automatically be filled in with a reference to the concrete object that we are creating or working with, on which we call the method, which means the lowercase m or the lowercase v. This is the default behavior of Python. And because it's a default behavior, we don't have to specify anything above the function. And by convention, we call this argument self to communicate that this is a reference to the concrete object. And whenever we want to work with a reference to the class object itself, then what we do is we just put this at class method above the function. And then by convention, we don't call the first parameter self, but we call it CLS for class. And then Python automatically puts in a reference to the class. So when we call the from columns method, we also only specify one argument. There is no two arguments here. And that is because the first argument is automatically filled in, but now it's not a reference to the concrete object, but it's a reference to the class blueprint. Okay, so it's actually not so hard. It just gets it needs a little getting used to, and then you can do it. Okay, so now another topic, sequence emulation. So we spent lots of time on analyzing sequences, in particular in chapter 7, but we've seen sequences before. Strings are also sequences in chapter 6. So what is a sequence? A sequence is any object in Python that fulfills four criteria, four properties. The first one is it has to be a container, so it's an object that contains references to other objects. That is obviously true for vectors and matrices, because vectors and matrices are just containers that contain numbers. So first property is fulfilled. The second property is these objects that are contained should be finite. We call that a sized object. And certainly, a matrix and a vector is also, you know, finite, at least for the vectors and matrices that we built here. If you asked a mathematician on that topic, they will probably tell you that there are vectors that contain an infinite number of components. But we are not so crazy as the math people. We are pragmatic programmers. So we just don't work with infinite vectors. So that is the second property. What is the third property? The third property is the iterable property. So we want to be able to loop over stuff. So we have kind of a hard time to see how we can loop over vectors and matrices. But for vectors, it's actually quite natural. If the vector 1, 2, 3 consists of three components, then why shouldn't we loop over the components in order from top to bottom in the vector? That makes sense. For a matrix, because it has two dimensions, we would have to make up an assumption. What is the order? Do we want to order in a row first way or in a column first way? And of course, as you can guess, we will loop over matrices in a row first way. But again, we can loop over the elements or the entries in a matrix. And then what's the fourth property of a sequence? We call that formally reversibility. And that just means we have to have a predictable order. And do vectors and matrices have a predictable order? Yes, they have. Vectors, definitely. And the matrices as well, right? Because we have like a coordinate, an XY coordinate for every entry in the matrix. So in a way, the numbers in a vector and in a matrix are ordered. So all the four properties that make up the meta concept of a sequence they are fulfilled for vectors and matrices. So now, that means we can use vectors and matrices in place of any object that also has those four properties. So let's see how we can implement these four properties for our vectors and matrices. Here is it. So we do it for a vector first, init and wrapper, we just ignore. And then we have two new special methods. The first one is called dunderlen. We can already guess that this would probably correspond to the len built-in function. And then we have dunderGetItem. dunderlen takes only one argument, self. That makes sense. You know, that's just a reference to the concrete vector. And then getItem takes two arguments. The first one, again, because it's an instance method, self. And then the second argument is index. That makes sense, because if we want to index into something, let's say you want to index into a list or into a string, how do we index? Well, by specifying an index. And an index is nothing but an integer starting at zero and upwards until a one minus the length. However, we also saw that we can have negative indices for classes, for lists and tuples and also strings. So that's basically the idea behind. And now what happens is we have this hidden entries list. self.underscore_entries is a list. It's just a list object which stores the numbers inside the vector, kept a secret from the user of the vector, but still it's a list. It's on the vector. So what do we do? Well, if we call the dunderlen method, all that we do is we call the len built-in function on the hidden list object. That's it. And because vectors are one-dimensional, then at the end of the day, the length of the inner list that holds all the numbers is also the length of the vector. So in other words, what this method does, it forwards the function call. So whenever the dunderlen is called, it forwards the function call to the inner list. It calls len with a reference to the inner list. And now let's look at getItem. What does it do? At first, we do a type checking. So we make sure that index is indeed an integer. And then we also forward the indexing. So what we do here is we just return the element of the element from the inner list called entries at the index position. And that's a smart way to do, because we know that self.underscore_entries is a list, so we can also index with negative indices. And by just forwarding the index parameter here, the thing is, we don't even have to implement the logic of indexing with negative numbers, because the list object that is hidden inside the vector takes care of that. So let's define a new vector, create a new instance of a vector with the numbers 1, 2, 3, 4 in it. And now I can call the built-in function len with v as the argument, and I get back 4. And now I can also index into the vector with index 0, and I get back 1. Why do I get 1.0? Why do I get back 1.0? Well, obviously, if we look at v, it lowercase v, it only contains floats, of course. And now let's check if we can how we can index. Let's try to get the last number. This would be index 3. This works. What happens if we provide an index of 4? We get an index error, list out of range. That's how we see that we implemented the vector with a list. However, we could also do like this, v index minus 1, and we also get a 4, right? Or index minus 3 to get, in this case, the 2. Okay, so indexing works. And the only two things that we needed to implement for the vector was dunderlen and dunderGetItem. And we also implement this, of course, as we shall see, for the matrix. I just put it here so that I won't forget. So these two special methods, they implement the length and the indexing. Now you wonder, there are two more properties missing. How can we loop? We didn't specify any looping. Well, guess what? Python is smart for us. It's very smart. So Python knows that if something can be indexed into, indexing means 0, 1, 2, 3. Indexing means there has to be an order. Otherwise, indexing doesn't make sense. So whenever we implement getItem, the dunder getItem method, we communicate to Python, hey, we are in order. This data type must have an order, because otherwise indexing wouldn't make sense. So we have order, we can index, and we have a length. We have a finite thing. Otherwise, we wouldn't have dunder length. So by just specifying dunder getItem and dunder length, we basically say, Python, you can loop. Because Python is smart enough to figure out that in order to loop over something that it can index into, it just starts with index 0, index 1, index 2, and so on, and goes to 1 minus the length. And because both the indexing works and Python can get the length, because we implemented it, that's why Python can figure out the looping on its own. We don't have to teach Python how to loop, because Python here just makes the next step automatically. So let's see. We can loop over V. We use V as if it were an iterable. And all of a sudden, we can loop over the vector. That's nice. We can also loop over the vector in reverse order, you know, because we do have an order to begin with. We have a length, so we know what is the last index. And Python just goes from the highest index back to 0 and can figure out the indexing or the looping on its own. And because looping works, we can also use the in operator. The in operator is the characteristic operator for the container property. And what does Python do now if I run this cell 3 in V? Well, what Python does behind the scenes, it does a linear search. It goes over the V object one at a time until it finds a component in the vector that evaluates equal to the number we are looking for. And if I specify, let's say, number 5, then Python will go from the first to the last element of the vector, and no number in the vector will evaluate equal to the 5, because of that, we get a false. Okay, so all the four characteristic operations of a sequence work by just specifying the dunder len and the dunder get item. Okay, that's nice. So, however, can we mutate the vector? So can I assign, for example, to the first index in the vector, the number 99. So can I replace the 1 with a 99? I get a type error. The vector does not support item assignment. Now, guess what? I'm not going to show you this here in the presentation, but there is a method that we used, dunder get item. I tell you, and this is also in the chapter that you can read, there is a method called dunder set item. And if you implement this, then you can actually do the item assignment as well. And this leaves us with the question of, should you allow that? Should you allow here updating an individual component in the vector? And that's the question as to whether we want to design the vector and the matrix classes as mutable objects or data types or immutable data types. Okay, and I told you that if we want to reason about code and analyze code, it is easier if we have immutable data types, which is why in the presentation here, I only show you the immutable version. But if you go back or if you go into the chapter and read the chapter, then you will see also an implementation of a mutable vector and a mutable matrix class that shows you how you can implement code so that you can actually change the matrix after it was created, but not in the presentation. And here's the same thing for the matrix class. So we have a new version here. And then in order to, let's just look at dunder len here. So dunder len does also something smart here. It returns the product of self and rows and times self and calls. Okay. And now what is n rows and n calls? Well, it's these properties that we've seen before, right? So in other words, in order to figure out the number of entries in the matrix, I don't have to do a lot of math here. I can just use the two properties and multiply them, and return the result, okay? So in other words, the dunderlen method reuses the code from the dunder n from n calls and n rows attributes here or properties. Okay, so that's also something that that is important. Just as we write functions to reuse code, we also write classes to reuse code, in particular to reuse code among or across objects of a different type because they all share the same functions. But also within the blueprint, we also want to reuse code. And we do that all over the place here, actually. So even in the initializer, you also see that I'm comparing to self and calls. And that's a cool thing. So in the moment when the matrix is initialized, we can already use the nCalls property, which does this calculation. So we use nCalls, which is here, already up in the initializer. And also, note this, in the initializer, when I check if the user has provided at least one number in data, we use the len built-in and call it on self. And that looks weird, right? But what that does is, what len with self does, it dispatches the flow of execution down here to the dunderlen method. And then dunderlen method runs, and it looks at those two numbers and dispatches the flow of execution here and here. And once we get the result back, then the dunderlen returns to here, and then the result is compared to zero. And if it is zero, we get the value error. So you see how not only code that is at the bottom uses code that is in the top, but also code in the top uses code in the bottom. So we have like a really sophisticated way of code reusing each other. Okay, and then the dunder get item method is a little bit more sophisticated. Why? Well, I not only want to implement indexing by an individual integer, but I also want to implement indexing as a coordinate system, so to say. So I want to be able to specify, to say, give me the entry in the first row and the first column. And that's why the code here is a little bit longer. But if you read it at home, there's nothing in it that is hard. And again, here maybe we use diffmod in an intelligent way. But all of this is not so hard to do. And we do also type dispatching. So when index is an int, then we allow then we do the indexing by one integer. But if the index is not an instance of int, but if it is a tuple and a tuple consists of two numbers, then we do this indexing by a coordinate system. And if the index is something other, then actually we raise a type error and tell the user that this is not a legal way to do the indexing. So let's see the new matrix class, the new matrix object. What can we do now? Now we have a 2x2 matrix. A 2x2 matrix has four entries. So len of m should give us four, it does. And then I can index into the matrix with, as I said, with a integer index. And let's say if I get the second index, what I get is a 2. So the indexing goes also one row at a time. That's also important. So the indexing is row first, row major. And then I can also, as I said, do the indexing with a coordinate. So if I say m, 0 index, 0, 1, 0, 1 is really a tuple. So we are leaving out the parentheses, but it's really a tuple. And the first 0 means get the entry in the first row. And the 1 means give me the entry in the second column. So this would be the 2. Okay. And then, of course, because I have dunderlen and dunderGetItem, I can do looping. So let's loop over the matrix. And again, we get the row major version. And of course, because of the indexing, I can also go in reverse order. And because the looping works, I can do a linear search of all the numbers that are in the matrix and can check is the 1, for example, in the matrix. It is, and I can also check is the 0, the 10 in there, and then it goes over all the entries, and it won't find the 10. And after it has gone over all the entries in the matrix, it says false. So it's a linear search. It's a slow version of a search, just remember, if we need to search in a fast way, we should probably use a dictionary. Dictionaries we covered extensively in chapter 8. We could also actually build a matrix around a dictionary. This would also be a nice way. But here we built the matrix around an inner list of lists. So that is why searching in the matrix is rather slow. So you already see with this short comment that the implementation details, they actually matter. So it matters of what the user of the matrix class is more likely to do. If the user of the matrix class is more likely to search elements inside the matrix, then this would not be a good matrix because the inner list. But if we used a dictionary inside, then of course the matrix would have lots more memory usage because we saw, because of the hash table implementation in chapter 8, that dictionaries have a lot of empty memory by design so that the searching goes fast. And we don't want to do that with a matrix. Why? Well, because a matrix, if we have, let's say, a big matrix, say a 10 million by a 10 million matrix, and we build this around a dictionary, then we will use very much memory, actually. So this is the questions that you have to answer if you design a library. What is the common use cases for the users of the library? And then you have to make the assumption. And here we made the assumption that we just use a list of lists. Okay. This was the sequence emulation. So dunder len, dunder get item. And now we have some more special methods. And you get the point now, right? We will introduce more and more special methods. And the special methods usually in their name already tell you with which built-in function, for example, they work with. So dunder len goes with the built-in len function and so on. And this will not change too much. So let's look at a different way of looping. So if we went back, the previous version of matrix allowed us only to loop over the entries in the matrix in a row major way. And what this new version does, I will only quickly go over it. It provides instance methods called rows, calls, and entries here. And what they do is they allow us to loop over the matrix row by row, column by column, or over the individual entries. So when we loop over a matrix by rows, what we can do is, and this is what we do here, is we can interpret every row in a matrix as a vector. Just as we can interpret every column in a matrix as a vector, which is why this generator expression that gets returned gives back individual vectors. So for every row in entries here, in the inner entries list, we create a new vector. And this is just to show you how you can really tailor make some instance methods to provide more ways of, in this case, looping to a user. So now the user with this new version can actually decide if they want to go over the matrix in a row by row or column by column way and then loop over individual vectors. Or you still want to go over the entries one at a time. And then the entries method here takes two more arguments called reverse and row major that have default values. So by default, we go in forward order and not in reverse order. And by default, we go in row major way and not in column major way. And then what this method does, it gives the user many ways to customize the way in which they want to go over the matrix. Okay, so these are three new instance methods. This is just examples of instance methods. So this I could have shown you this actually already in the section on instance methods versus class methods, because there is nothing new here. But then the one thing that is here that belongs to the iteration idea is the dunder iter and the dunder reversed special methods. And so what does dunder iter do? So whenever we use the Python's built-in iter function with an object, what Python does is it goes into the object's blueprint, so in this case, the matrix class blueprint, and tries to find dunder iter. And then what does dunder iter do? Dunder iter by default makes the matrix loop over the entries in forward order and row measure. So this is why there are no arguments specified. So in other words, Thunder Iter also dispatches the flow of execution to dot entries. And in the same way, Thunder reversed dispatches the flow of execution to entries again, but now sets the reverse flag to true so that iteration is now in backwards order. And yeah, this is what the Python's reversed built-in calls. So whenever you reverse, which we have done a lot of times, whenever we say for something in reversed something, then every time we do this, the Thunder reversed on this particular object will be called. Okay, so let's see what this means. So I create a new matrix, of course. And now I want to loop over the matrix one row at a time. And I won't get back the row as a tuple or a list, but I get back every row as a vector. So now also, what does this tell us? This means now, so far, before this example actually, so far we have only seen the vector class and the matrix class independently. So whatever the matrix did only affected a matrix, and whatever a vector did only affected a vector. But now we have our first example of a method, the entries method, or in the rows method here, where doing something with a matrix returns us a vector. So whenever we loop over the rows, in this case, one at a time, in every iteration of the loop, Python gives us back a vector object, so a new instance of class vector. So in other words, the matrix and the vector classes, the blueprints, they are related. And that makes sense, right? So we have here special methods, no instance methods, I mean rows, calls, and entries. And then we have seen Thunder Iter. And what else? Thunder Reverse. So, of course, the space in this blueprint won't be enough to fill in everything you will see, but you get the point. So let's loop over the rows. We see that. We can also loop over the calls, and we get back vector objects, vector instances, but one column at a time. And then finally, we can go over all the entries. And dot entries will just, by default, as we saw, go in forward order in row measure fashion. So nothing new. But now I can go ahead and pass in a keyword argument, row measure equals false, and that allows us to loop over the individual entries in the matrix in a column measure way. Okay, and of course, we could also just loop over the matrix still without a method. So the loops all here call some method, some instance method. But here, we just loop over M itself. And what that means is Python looks up the Thunder Iter method on the blueprint. And then, as we saw, the Thunder Iter will just dispatch to the entries method, which is why we just get back the entries in forward order. And then we can use, of course, the reverse built-in and go in backward order. That's what the Thunder reverse special method does. So now, you know, you get the point. So by defining more and more methods and special methods on the matrix and vector classes, we can now you know, work with M and V in a more intuitive way. I mean, now, at this point in time, the matrix object M, lowercase m here, can do anything that we could also do with a list. So the looping, the container, and you know, all these things, they work just as if we had a list. However, we have some additional methods like rows and calls and entries that allow us to even customize that. So this is like, at the moment, it's basically like a list on steroids here. And this is really what it is, because when we started this chapter, we modeled a matrix as a list of lists, and it couldn't do any math. And now we taught the list of lists, because a matrix is just a list of lists, and we taught it how to do some special things. And Python learned, so now we can reuse all of this. But so far, we haven't taught Python any linear algebra yet. This is yet to come. But the looping and, you know, all the stuff, the sequence emulation, the iteration part, all of this we have basically taught Python already. Okay, let's go on. And now another topic, something that we have seen before with a different name. That's just an easy topic here. We have talked about duck typing several times in this course. Duck typing means that if I can pass in different types of objects to a function, for example, and the function still works with all the different types of objects, then we say that all the objects, they walk and quack alike. And because of that, what we can also say is that in Python, the type of an object is not so important. The thing that is important is how the object behaves. And when we are in the context of classes, of object-oriented programming, there is this technical term called polymorphism, which means is we have different things, that's what the poly means, that behave in the same way. So, example, I use the built-in sum function with a tuple 1, 2, 3, 4. And it works, gives me 10. I use the built-in sum function with a list 1, 2, 3, 4. It works. So the sum function, in other words, only relies on the fact that it can iterate over the object we pass in, and the object we pass in must be finite. I cannot take the sum of an infinite object. But other than that, these are the only two properties, looping, iterable, and finiteness that we need. And we have seen this before in chapter 5, when we also looked into abstract base classes for the first time. Remember when we looked at the complex number, the float data type, and so on, and then we classified them in abstract terms, and then we implemented something, some logic called goose typing at the end of chapter 5. This is something similar. Back then, in chapter 5, we classified individual numbers, and we said that, among others, the integer walks and quacks like a float. Because, you know, the integer 3 behaves like the float 3.0, so they behave alike. But now we extend this to the next level, and we look at bigger types, not individual types or simple types like, for example, numbers, scalar types, but now we look at some composite types, like tuples, lists, and so on, and they also behave alike. So in this case, a tuple behaves like a list, but that's nothing new. We knew that in chapter 7 already. But now I can also take the sum of the vector, and this vector, the current v I have in memory, also has the numbers 1, 2, 3, 4 in it. So now sum of v works. So how does the sum built-in function, you know how to deal with a vector? Well, the thing is, it doesn't. The sum built-in function only knows how to go over an iterable until its end, and until the finite elements are over, and just add up all the numbers in a running total way. And that's it. That's all the sum function knows how to do. And because we can loop over vectors, and because vectors are finite, that's what the dunderland is for, that's why we can call the sum built-in function with v. But we can also call it with m. It's also 10. If I have a 2x2 matrix, currently, but lowercase m that has the numbers 1, 2, 3, and 4 in it, it doesn't even matter in what order I loop over them. The only thing that matters is I can loop from beginning to end, and they add up to 10. So that's an example of polymorphism. Objects of different types behave alike. And in the book, in the chapter, there is a function called norm that looks at the vector and matrix norms, and does the same here in the context of linear algebra. But here in the presentation, I just keep the example simple. So we just look at the idea of summing up the individual numbers inside some container. But we can also extend the idea of polymorphism to functions. So what is polymorphism? Basically, it means we have, in this case, a function that is capable of working with objects of different types. And we know by now that as the programmer who implement the classes, we are the responsible person to make sure that the sum function can work with a vector or a matrix. And we do that by writing the special methods. Let's see another topic, which means I call it representations of data. So in math, I know that I told you that you don't, I don't expect you to know lots of linear algebra for this chapter, but let's say you have a matrix X that gets multiplied by a vector Y. Any vector that we multiply a matrix by from the right side may be, and usually is, interpreted as a matrix that consists of only one column. And then we say that the vector is a column vector. Similarly, when I multiply a matrix by a vector from the left-hand side, I oftentimes assume that the vector is a matrix with one row, and the row is just the entries of the vector. In other words, I can view a vector as a matrix of either one column or either one row. And because of that, what we really say is that the data inside the vector is the same data. It doesn't matter if the data is modeled as a vector or a matrix. It's the same data. So we have two different ways of representing the same data. And so what we do here is, in the vector class, we define a new method, an instance method, called sMatrix, that does one thing. It returns a new matrix object, a new instance of a matrix, that is either a 1 by n or n by 1 matrix, where all the entries in the elements are the components of the vector. Okay? So now I can, you know, convert, so to say, any vector I have into a matrix. But I don't really convert a vector, because once a vector object like V, for example, exists in memory, I can never change the type. The only thing I can do is I can create a new object with a different type. So basically what the sMatrix method does, it creates a new box of type matrix and puts the data from the vector inside the matrix and arranges them in either a row as a row or a column. Okay. Similarly, I can do the same thing for a matrix. So the matrix now is given a new instance method called sVector that allows us to take the data inside a matrix and make a vector out of it. Now the problem is, if we have a matrix, a concrete example of a matrix that has more than one row or more than one column, then how do we do that? Because vectors are one-dimensional. The answer is we can't. And because we cannot do that, in this situation, we check for that. And if the matrix has either more, like here it says, if the matrix does not have either one row or one column, then we throw an error. And the error is called runtime error. So because at runtime something goes wrong, and we say one dimension M or N in the matrix must be one. Just a side note, of course, we could assume if we had a matrix that is not does not fulfill these conditions, that has more than one row and more than one column, then we could still force it to become a vector by just, you know, following the two-dimensional entries in the matrix, either in a row major or column major way, and by this way creating a vector. But then the vector will be longer than the matrix is either wide or high. And so I chose to raise an arrow here. I think this is more consistent, but you could think of a case where you could adapt this. But at the end of the day, if we are given a matrix of either one row or one column, we can create a vector out of it. And how do I do that? Well, very easy. We just return a new vector, so we call the vector class, and all we pass to the vector class is, and that's also so nice syntax, object orientation is really super beautiful in code. So all we do is we pass in a generator expression and say x for x in self. And this is so smart, because what this does, it creates a new vector, and data is a generator expression that gets, you know, that loops over self. And how can you loop over a matrix? Well, looping over a matrix means we dispatch to the iter special method, and the iter special method knows how to do that. And that's just a shortened version here. The original example of iter was different before, but that's not the point here. The point is that we look at this method, the sVector method, And the S-vector method creates a new vector out of a matrix. And we see again an example of how we reuse code from within one method from another. And this is, I think, when once you get used to this level of coding, then, you know, if you look at a code base, it's really like an art to read. There's really lots of thinking that goes into designing nice libraries, and you can always learn by studying someone else's libraries. How do people think? So let's create a new vector, v. And this is, of course, one-dimensional, so we can make it a matrix. How do we do that? We just call the sMatrix method on it, and then store that as m. And now m is a new vector, a new matrix. And in this case, it's obviously a 3x1 matrix, a column matrix, or a column vector. So the dimensions are 3x1. And then when I go ahead and call sMatrix here on v, I get back a matrix object. And then a matrix object comes with a method called sVector. So what I can do is I can call sMatrix on a vector object and immediately call by method chaining sVector again. And then I get back a new instance of a vector which has the same numbers in it than the vector started out with. So here I get back the same vector. It's not the same vector. It's a new object with a different with the same numbers in it. And we can do the same for a matrix. However, here the example is I have a 2x2 matrix, and I try to make it a vector. And just to illustrate a point, sVector now throws the runtime error because we don't want that to happen. And now comes the fun part. Now comes the part where we teach our vector and matrix classes how to do linear algebra. And this is, of course, this has to do with operator overloading. Because our initial example in this chapter was I had x times y, so I had the multiplication operator, and it threw a type error, and I want to fix that. So somehow I have to teach Python that the multiplication works different for you know, in the context of matrices and vectors. So in other words, I have to overload the arithmetic operators. And we've seen that many times before. Just think the plus operator is addition when we work with numbers, but the plus operator is also concatenation when we work with strings. So that's the same thing that we saw many examples of. Now we do that ourselves. So first, we do that for the arithmetic operators. And before we do that, we have to think up how many different cases can there be when we do some arithmetic with either a vector and another vector, or with a matrix and another matrix, or with the mixture of them. So, for example, what we have to, and you will see this in the chapter when you read it, but not in the presentation. So when I want to do addition, only look at addition and subtraction, I can do that for vectors with vectors. And this only works if both vectors have the same number of components, and also if I add or subtract, if I add two vectors, then what I mean with the technical term commutative here is if I have a vector A and a vector B, I can calculate A plus B, but I can also calculate B plus A, it will be the same. So these are the kind of thoughts you should make when you design you know, your library, and then we can add or subtract two matrices. And then the thing is, can we, and that's what, something that I made up, but NumPy does that too, so that's why it's in there. Can I add or subtract from a matrix or vector a scalar? You know, you would say, for those of you who know a little bit about linear algebra, can you add the number 1 to the vector 1, 2, 3? Well, that doesn't make sense in linear algebra, but in NumPy, the people decided that this actually does make sense. And so we do that too. It's called broadcasting. It's a very easy concept. But for those of you who studied a little bit NumPy and get used to broadcasting, you don't want to miss it. But here is now in the code, I will show you how this works. And at least in this chapter, if you read it, you will understand how broadcasting can be done. And then there are all the various ways of how to multiply vectors and matrices. A vector with a vector is called the dot product, for example. you can multiply a matrix with a vector. You can also multiply a vector with a matrix. So remember that multiplying a matrix by a vector from the right and from the left is two different things, and so on. So you really have to think, how many ways are there to have two objects of either kind work with each other? And these are all the operations that we have to implement. And I will show you a subset of that. But the final version of matrix and vector classes in our chapter here will actually cover all of that. So let's look at an example. So what happens is, it's maybe, let maybe give you an easier example. Yeah, let's maybe, let's do this. So how does Python work when the operators are executed? So I already told you this. I think I would have to check. I think it was in chapter 3, but it doesn't matter in which chapter it was. Let's say I write 1 plus 1, or let's say 1 plus 2, and evaluate this cell. I get back a 3. What happens in memory? Well, what happens in memory is the following. Python creates a new object with the 1 in it of type int, and a second object with a 2 in it, also of type int. And then what Python does, it goes to the object of the left-hand side of the plus operator and says, hey, 1, do you know how you can add yourself to the 2? And then the 1 says, well, I'm an integer. The 2 is an integer. I know how to add integers. And then what happens is they add themselves up. The 3, it will become an int. And then, of course, they are forgotten because they only exist in memory as an intermediate object, so to say. And then what happens is, what we see in the Jupyter Notebook is the 3 is given back as the output, right? But then, because we don't store it in a variable, this gets forgotten as well. But the important thing is that's what happens in memory. And now let's do a second example. Let's add the number 1 plus the float 2.0. So integer plus float. Execute that. I get back 3.0. Note there is a difference. But now what happens in memory? So what happens is Python will create a new 1 of type int. And then it will create a somewhat bigger box with a 2.0. Needs some more or some other structure of bits to model the decimals, and it's of type float. And then Python goes ahead and asks the 1, the integer, hey, integer, do you know how to add yourself to 2.0, the float? And then the integer says, well, no. I don't know the idea of decimals. I don't understand what decimals are. I'm an integer. I don't know that. And then it reports back to Python and says, I can't do the operation. I don't know addition. And then what Python does, it goes to the float object and says, hey, float, do you know how you can add yourself to the int? And then the float says, yeah, no problem. Any integer, I know that any integer is just the same number that I have here before the decimal, plus a decimal and all zeros. The float knows that. So what the float does, the float reports back, the result should be 3.0, another float. And then Python takes that result. And of course, the two operands, the left and the right operand, they go away. And then in Jupyter Notebook, we get the output back, 3.0. And because we don't store it away, the output gets lost. That's the logic of how the plus operator works, and this is true for any other operator that takes two operands as well. So I showed you the example of the comparison operator in chapter 3. Yes, comparison operator in chapter 3. You can watch the recording of that. You will see the same thing, just not a plus, but a double equal sign. So let's analyze this pattern. Let's make this a little bit more generic. So let's say let's say, assume that I have a vector 1 and I add a vector 2. How does that work? How does that work? So let's assume I created vector 1 and vector 2 before. I have not done that, but let's assume they exist. So what Python then does is, somewhere in memory, there is a vector, let's say 1, 2, 3. And this is of type vector, vector. And I call this vector 1. And this is the reference that goes here. And then somewhere else in memory, I have another vector. And just for illustration purposes, that would be 4, 5, 6. Can be any numbers, doesn't matter. And it's of type vector. And the name is vector 2. And the reference goes here. Then what Python will do in this example, it will, of course, also go to the left-hand side first and say, hey, you object, I don't know what you are. I don't know what a vector is. I'm Python. I'm stupid. I don't know what a vector is. But do you know how you can calculate? And then the vector says, well, let me look at the other operand. And the other operand happens to be also a vector. And in this case, what would we want to happen? Well, we would actually, you know, intuitively think that one vector knows how to add itself to another vector, and we will see that this works. And so the left operator knows, the left operand knows how to do that, and so the left operand will go away. And let's assume that, just for illustration purposes, and we will see an example of that later, I want to add vector 1 plus 10, the number, the integer 10. What Python will now do is, the vector 1 object already exists, it will create a new object, number 10 in it, an int, and then, or maybe let's do this. To get the example right, let's say 10 plus vector 1. So what Python does is, it will create a 10, and then the vector 1 is still there, and so Python will go to the left operand, the 10 here, and say, hey, int, do you know how to calculate, how to add yourself to a vector? And then the int says, well, I have no idea what the vector is. And then Python says, okay, that's okay, and returns to the right operand, the vector now, and then says, do you know how you add yourself, how an int could be added to you? I mean, we will just see in just a moment how this can make sense, but and then the vector in our example would say yes and no. And the thing to understand is, whenever the left operand, in this case the 10, knows how to do the addition or the operation, then this is just the common, you know, addition, subtraction, and so on. Whenever the left operand does not know that, we will. What Python does is, it will ask the right operand to do the so-called reversed operation of the same kind. So reversed is the important word here. And as we shall see, this will be abbreviated with an R. And this is how the logic is. So this is what I just, you know, showed you in with all the examples. That's the only thing that you really need to understand. And now, let's see how we can implement that with special methods. So let's only look at addition. There is, of course, a dunder add method, special method. And this method knows how to do addition, or that's where we implement the addition logic. And so what we do is, we first have here an if statement that checks. So first of all, maybe let's begin the beginning. So what does dunder add take? Dunder add takes two arguments. The first one is always itself, and the other argument, by convention, we call it other. And other is the thing that is on the right-hand side. So in other words, whenever I do some operation, like let's say the plus, basically I write, this is what you should think of, self plus other. And then on self, the dot add method is called, and other is passed in as the argument. So self, of course, here is passed in because it's the instance on which we call it, and then other is given to it. And then self can do one of two things. Either it knows how to handle the situation, or it doesn't. And now, let's look at the code here, the dunder add function. So where's the case where the ad does not know what to do, well, it's obviously down here, not implemented. And what return not implemented means is, that means the left-hand object says, I have no idea what to do. That's the situation. And before that, we have two other situations. The first one is that other that is given to the self is checked for its type. And if both objects, self and other, have the same type, which we check here, then in this case, we do vector addition. And how is vector addition done? Well, we create a new vector, and then we have a generator expression where we loop over both vectors one at a time and just add the components x plus y for x and y in the SIP of self and other. So I hope that by now you know what the SIP does and all of that. But at the end of the day, so just we create a new vector where every component is just the sum of the components of the two vectors that we start out with. And then there is an elif, and the elif says, if other is any number, abstractly speaking, what we do is we create a new vector, and we add to every component x in the vector other, the constant. And this is what broadcasting is, and we will see that soon. But at the end of the day, that's addition. So addition basically is asked on the left-hand side. If we are the left operand, then the dunder add is executed. And then in dunder add, we check what is the type of the right object. So is the right object another vector, or is it a number? And if it's neither of the two, what happens is the dunder add method says not implemented. And that's the case where self says to Python, hey, I have no idea how addition works. And then what Python does, if self says, I cannot, you know, I don't know how to do addition, what Python then does, it goes to other and calls on the other object, dunder, and now here comes the trick, rAdd. And it gives it as argument self. And what is rAdd? Reverse addition. And where is rAdd here? It's just the next special method. So this is what happens when the object that we are looking at is on the right side, is the right operand, and the left one didn't know how to add it. Okay? And then in this case, because vector addition is commutative, so it doesn't matter if I have a vector A plus a vector B, I can also say B plus A. What I do here is I just return self plus other, and this is also dispatching the flow of execution to dunder add. And this only works because addition is commutative. And let's look at subtraction. And subtraction is not commutative because A minus B is something different than B minus A. And again, dunder sub is the method that is called when, you know, when I say A minus B, then what happens is we call the method A dunder sub and pass it the argument B. And in the case where A does not know what to do, so whenever this method returns not implemented, as we saw, then what Python does, it asks the right operand, and the right operand will be asked like this, B dot dunder R sub, reverse subtraction, and then we pass in the A. So either the left operand does the operation or the right one does. Right? So that's it. That's the entire logic. So it sounds complicated in the beginning, and maybe back in chapter 3, you were already wondering, why am I telling you stories of, we asked the left one, can you work with the right one? And then we asked the right one, can you work with the left one? This seems very tedious when back in chapter 3, I told you that. But now you understand why this has to be the case. And the reason why this has to be so is because when we create new types, like here, the vector and the matrix type, we want them to be able to work with the built-in types. And the built-in types, like int, for example, or tuple, or list, or whatever, they exist in core Python. And when core Python was developed, the Python developers did not know about our vector and matrix classes. So whenever we write our own classes, they have to take over. You know, a built-in type will never know how to do some arithmetic with our custom classes. It's always our custom classes that have to be taught how to work with the built-ins. And this is what we do here. This is why we do all the type dispatching here. And then you see there is a dunder mul, and RML that that implements multiplication. And for multiplication, we also see that multiplication is commutative. And then in the case of multiplication, what we do is we check if other is also a vector, and if self is a vector, so, I mean, self has to be a vector because we are in the vector class, right? We are in the vector class, so self is always a vector. But let's say other is also a vector, which is this case, then what we do is we multiply the two vectors. What do we do? We take the dot product, and the dot product is just the product of the component of each component of both vectors, and then we add up and get the sum. So, but again, linear algebra, I don't assume you know. So this would be the dot product case. If I multiply a vector by a vector, this is the dot product. And then, of course, if I multiply a vector by a scalar, by a number, this is this here, then I do scalar multiplication. How does scalar multiplication work? Well, I just create a new vector where every component is just x times other, and other is just the scalar, the constant. And here, I use, again, a generator expression, and I loop over self. But, you know, I mean, this just all repeats itself. And if other is neither a vector nor a scalar number, then I just return not implemented. And because multiplication is, for vectors at least, commutative, we can, in this case, in the RML special method, just return self times other. And what does self times other do? Well, self times other just dispatches to the MUL special method. Okay, that's it. So I know that this may be a lot to understand in the recording, but at the end of the day, before you know, I want you to understand the big picture here, and the big picture is if you have whenever you work with an operator that has a left and a right operand, we always ask the left operand to do the operation. If the left operand doesn't know how to do it, the right one gets asked, and asking the right one will result in the same method call, just with the R prefix for reversed, because then the two operands are just reversed. And in many, many cases, the R sub or the R add or the R mul, that just dispatches to the non-reversed version. But in cases where the two operands, where the operation is not commutative, then we must not do that. We have to do something else. Okay. And then let's define this new vector class. So what can we do? I create a new vector. And now what I can do is I can say 2 times v. And remember, v used to be a tuple. And what would happen? Maybe let's compare this. So 2 times v. And v is 1, 2, 3, so now I get back 2, 4, 6. This is just scalar multiplication. And just to contrast this, on the slide further, so here I have a vector that is created from a list, 1, 2, 3. So let's take the same list, 1, 2, 3, and just multiply the list, 1, 2, 3, with 2. What does that do? Well, it gives us back a new list, 1, 2, 3, comma, 1, 2, 3. So this is a list concatenation. So the multiplication operator for lists just does concatenation. And now what we did effectively, Python, because our vector is also, you know, internally it's a list. So what we just did is we taught Python that the standard behavior for list concatenation is not what we want. We want scalar multiplication. And now here we taught Python how to do linear algebra. We taught Python here how to do scalar multiplication. And then, of course, we can also multiply the scalar from the right. This is the same, works the same. And of course, at the end of the day, we can multiply two vectors. So in this situation, I multiply v with itself, v times v. And this will, of course, be the dot product. And the dot product is just the sum of the, you know, the two. Let's quickly put the v here. So it's just 1, 2, and 3. So the dot product would be just 1 times 1 plus 2 times 2 plus 3 times 3, and this would be 14 then. But again, linear algebra definitions you should know as a data scientist one day. But for now, I want you to understand how the object-oriented features work in Python. So I want you to understand how you can do operator overloading on your own for your custom data types, and it's not about the particular math rules here. And then, of course, we can do vector plus vector. It works. We can say a vector minus itself gives us the zero vector. This is nice, so we know this must be correct. And now comes the thing that NumPy basically does by default. So I have a vector 1, 2, 3. So just to see, this is the vector 1, 2, 3. And now I add a constant 100 to the vector. And in linear algebra, this would be illegal. But in NumPy, it's not. And because we want to re-implement NumPy on our own, what we do is we just add 100, the constant 100, to every component in the vector. So now this would be 101, 102, 103. And this in NumPy is called broadcasting. And here in the source code, in the documentation, in the docstring, I also speak of broadcasting here. So this is inspired by NumPy. And we can also do 100 minus V, for example. So this works. Okay. Pooh. Now we say it's getting even bigger, right? But now let's do that real quick. So we are in the new matrix class, and we also have an add. We also have a reverse add. We have sub, reverse sub. And of course, we have to do some more type dispatching, because now, what did we implement here for addition and subtraction? Well, what we did is, whenever I add a matrix to a matrix, I just do ordinary matrix multiplication. However, this only works if the dimensions of both matrices match. So here we have, so that's why we have a check here. It checks if the n rows of both self and other, and also the n calls of self and other match. Otherwise, the matrices don't match, and we cannot do that. But if it works, then a new matrix will be created, where every entry is just the sum of the two entries from both of the matrices. And then the second case does the broadcasting again. So if we add a scalar to a matrix, it also should work. For the reversed operator, we dispatch again, the same as for sub. And then the most of the logic here has to go into the multiplication, because if I have a matrix and I multiply it with another matrix, that's one case, but I can also multiply a matrix by a vector. I can also multiply a vector by a matrix. And of course, I can multiply a matrix by a scalar, so, or a scalar by a matrix. So there are many, many cases that we have to cover. And that's what we do here in MUL. That's the standard multiplication and reverse MUL. And as you will see inside it, I do some tricks. So when you multiply a matrix by a vector, what is commonly done, as I already said, is that we view the vector as a matrix too. So when we multiply a matrix by a vector from the right, we view the vector as a column vector, so as a n by 1 matrix. And why is that important? Why do we say that? Well, we know how we can change the representation of a vector into a matrix. We just call the S matrix method on the vector. And then all we need to do is we have to write one logic that does a matrix-matrix multiplication. This is this hidden function. So also see the leading single underscore means that this function, this method, is not to be used by someone that uses our matrix object. This will only be used internally. So the matrix multiply method is, for example, used here, matrix multiply. But it's only used internally from within another method. And then what we do here is we dispatch all the different cases. And then, for example, if I have another vector, what I do is I change the vector into a matrix. I do the matrix-matrix multiplication. And then the result of that will be returned as a vector again. So in this case, if you think all the examples through, then what you will see is that you only really need to implement matrix-matrix multiplication once, and all the other cases can be reduced to a matrix-matrix multiplication. And that also allows us to understand, to reuse code. So in this example, it pays off to study linear algebra and to be good at linear algebra, because the more we understand about this problem domain, the nicer we can write the code. And that means the more maintainable the code is, the more reuse within the code will be, and so on. This will just make the code better. And yeah, so this is now getting very crowded here. But at the end of the day, all of the code that we put in just implements now all the logic that we will now see with the next example. So let's create two matrices, M and N. And for example, M, a matrix, we can now do scalar multiplication. We can here say 2 times M plus M times 3 divided by 5. This is, of course, 5 times M divided by 5. So we should get back M. We do. We can subtract the matrix from each other, so we get a zero matrix. We can multiply now two matrices. And there is actually a video in the chapter that you can watch to refute a matrix multiplication. And then, of course, if we multiply two matrices, then the number of columns of the left matrix has to match the number of rows of the right matrix. Otherwise, we cannot do the matrix multiplication, which is why here I get a value errors. The matrices don't have compatible dimensions. So even though we are in pragmatic coding here, we have to respect the mathematical rules here. And now we can do matrix times vector. And this is basically what we started out in this chapter, in the beginning. This is what we wanted to achieve. So now we have a matrix times a vector, and it works. And if we have a vector times another matrix, it also works. But let me see. I think the example was supposed to be V times M. And then we get a value error, because also when we multiply a matrix by a vector or a vector by a matrix, then also certain requirements about the dimensions have to be fulfilled. And yeah, so this is how we implement arithmetic on our own data types. So maybe let's write some of the stuff here. Let's say we have dunder add. Of course, we have dunder sub. What else? Dunder mul. I think dunder true div, I abbreviated it as just div. And we have the same here as well. So we see that already the blueprints of the matrix and the vector get very crowded. You know, the thing is, as before, there is always a certain special method that corresponds to, you know, one syntactical rule in Python. And for example, just as dunder len relates to the len built-in function, the dunder add relates to the plus operator. So for most of the things in Python, for most of the syntax in Python, there is always a special method that we can define to change or adapt the behavior of instances of the certain type within a certain situation in Python. And again, we have seen in the documentation the Python data model page, where we see all the special methods that exist. And now that was arithmetic. And now we still want to implement some other operators, for example, the relational operators. This is still an example of operator overloading. So let's say I have two vectors here, V and W. Both are the vectors 1, 2, and 3. And now I want to check, is V equal to W? And the answer is false. And that doesn't make sense, because both vectors have the same components. So they should evaluate equal, but they don't. So we have to teach Python what it means for two vectors to have the same components. Or we also have to teach Python what it means for two matrices to have the same entries. A side note, I compare here now V to itself. So I ask the question, is V equal to V? And the answer is true. So the comparison operator, the double equal operator, it seems to work whenever I compare an object to itself. And this is because Python does the following. Python first looks at the identity of the left operand, and then it looks at the identity of the right operand. And if it sees in memory that we are really comparing one object to itself, it's the same object, the same box, then Python will just take a shortcut and say that's definitely true. You know, it does not ask the object to compare itself to itself. Okay, so let's continue and define a new version of the vector class. And now it has this EQ special method here. And what does the EQ special method do? It does a quality comparison. And all it does here, it takes two arguments, self and other, and we also already know what is self, that is a vector, and other is any other object that is on the right-hand side of the equal operator. And then what happens is, Python first checks if the two have the same class, or if other is of the same class as me, or in other words, if other is a vector. And then what Python does here, or what our implementation does, we compare other two, do the two vectors have the same number of components? And if not, then we cannot compare them. That makes sense. That is important here, an important detail, because, I mean, we could also say that a vector with five components, if I compare it to a vector with six components, should return false here, right? Because they don't evaluate equal. But here we rather raise an error, because we don't want the user to compare objects or vectors of different lengths with each other. And then, if we get through this test, then we loop over both self, the self vector and the other vector in a pairwise fashion. And then what we do, that goes back to what we learned in chapter 5, we look at the absolute difference between the two components and check if the difference, the absolute value of the difference is greater than the threshold, a zero threshold. And to do that, I defined a class variable, zero threshold, and then I call self.zero threshold. So also there is something other going on, but let's finish reading this. So what I do here is, because we model our vectors and matrices to consist of only floats, because of that, we cannot compare the components in the vector for exact equality, because we know that floating point numbers are not precise, which is why we take the absolute value of the difference and compare that against some threshold. And then if we find a single pair of components that, you know, is over, whose difference is over the threshold, then I immediately return false. Why? Because then, you know, once I find one pair that, you know, is not within the threshold, I know the two vectors are different. And so in other words, what does this return do? The return is within a for loop. What that means is the for loop is exited early. So this is also an example of the early exit pattern here, which if we write a return statement within a for loop and this is hit, then the for loop also executes, also finishes immediately. Okay, and what else is there? So as we just realized, I want to, you know, I have to compare the absolute difference to a certain threshold. And what do I do? How do I do that? Well, I define a threshold. I don't hard code the threshold here. This is why I define the threshold to be 12 decimals to the right of the zero. And now the thing is this, self.zero threshold does not exist. So what I instruct Python here to do is to look up the attribute zero threshold on the self object, so on the concrete instance here, and it doesn't exist. Why? Because the threshold is only defined here in the class blueprint, right? This is what it means to have a class variable up here. So zero threshold exists only once for the vector class, and it exists a second time for the matrix class, as we will see, but it does not exist. So the number 1 to the negative, or 10 to the negative 12 is only stored twice, once for the matrix, once for the vector. It is not stored for every instance, but whenever I try to look up a variable on an object that doesn't exist on the instance, what Python automatically does, it goes to the class and checks if the attribute exists here. And if so, it reads it. In other words, by using a class variable here, we have basically a common default value that is used for all the instances. It's just a minor detail. So, but again, here, the dunder EQ method either returns true or false, or as we see, raises a error. And now what we can do, after implementing this, I can do the example again, create two vectors V and W, and now they compare equal. Okay, so now I've taught Python what it means for two vectors to have the same components. Okay, now we are slowly getting to the end of the chapter, luckily. But if you go ahead and read the chapter, then you will see that we actually skipped some more stuff. And now I will show you the whole picture. And just to show you what the entire classes, the entire vector and matrix classes look like. And this will be super long. So first, we have the vector class. And I added some more documentation, because now that everything is the full code, I can afford to document everything. So we have some extensive documentation here, the docstring. This belongs to the class as a whole. And as we see, that the methods are also documented separately. So that's good style. Then we have some class variables. In the beginning, we saw the dummy class variable here on the vector class. And just now, just before, we saw the zero threshold. And there are some more class variables. And what you use class variables for usually is a default value as a default value that holds true for every instance of a class, unless the instance gets its own value for, in this case, storage typing or threshold. Okay, and then we have the initializer. We have the wrapper again, for the output that we can copy paste, for the text representation that we can copy paste back into a code cell, so that we can create a new vector in this case that has the same components, the same value, the same semantic value. Then I have dunder string method, which gives out the nice representation for me as the human, because let's say in the chapter, when you read it, you will see we also, there's a section where we create a very big matrix and a very big vector, so that you cannot really see all the numbers. And then this nice human-friendly text representation pays off. We have len get item for indexing. We have dunder iter for iteration. But here, and we have dunder reversed for reverse looping. We have the all the special methods that do the arithmetic, add, subtract, mul. We have some more that I skipped, like pause and negative for positive, for the unary plus and the unary negative minus operator. We can take the absolute value of a vector. This is also a function I skipped, the norm function, and so on. And then, of course, we document everything. That's just the vector. And also the matrix, the final matrix class, is getting very long, as we shall see. So this is really, it's just to illustrate a point. This is to illustrate that you can, when you write a bigger program for, let's say, a bigger study or maybe an application as for a business, then you will put most of your business know-how basically into classes. And classes are the way as to give semantic meaning to individual parts of your bigger program, and also to make individual components reusable. This is what instances basically are. And now that we have seen the big picture, let's quickly compare what we have achieved in this chapter with what NumPy actually gives us. And note again, in practice, always use NumPy. Don't re-implement your own vectors and matrices. But for studying purposes, I think vectors and matrices are nice, as we saw in this chapter. So let's start again with the same example as in the beginning. we create a vector y as a tuple, and we create a matrix x as a list of lists. And then we faced in the beginning the problem that I cannot multiply the matrix by the vector, I get a type error. The goal of this chapter was to fix that, to teach Python some math. And of course, if we use NumPy, it already knows some math. So how can we, how can we create so-called NumPy arrays, which we cover in chapter 9? How can we create NumPy arrays out of the tuple and the list of lists? Well, we just use the array constructor, np.array, to create n-dimensional arrays. And how do we create vectors and matrices in our version from the tuple and the list of lists? Well, in the very same way. So I just call vector y and matrix x. So I pass in what the y, the tuple, and the list of lists to the vector and the matrix class. And then the initializer runs and verifies that the data is good. And then we create a new vector and a new matrix object. Okay, so now I have a y array and an x array. This is the NumPy, what NumPy gives us. And I have y vec and x mat, which are the vectors and matrices that we built our own in this chapter. And now let's look at the y array. This is just an array, a one-dimensional thing. An array is just a, an n-dimensional array, as we saw in chapter 9. It's just a more generic version of a matrix, so to say. So it's an n-dimensional matrix in a way. If we look at our own y vector, the text representation, which one is nicer? I actually think that our version is nicer than NumPy's, but the NumPy version, of course, is the de facto standard. So And then, of course, the same for the matrix. This is the way how NumPy shows us that there are two dimensions. So NumPy, when used in Jupyter Notebook, have this nice formatted output here. And then I can, of course, look at our own matrix. How does our own matrix look like? Well, it does not look so nice, maybe. We only have this one-dimensional thing, and we only see that our matrix is two-dimensional because we have several parentheses inside it. But at the end of the day, the text representations are not the decisive thing if you want to evaluate what you use. So NumPy arrays come with a dot shape attribute that gives us the dimensions of the matrix or the vector. So if I call yArray.shape, then I get back a tuple with only one element in it and three. And that means that y, in this case, consists of three components. How do we do that for the matrix in NumPy? We also call dot shape. So in other words, in NumPy, both a vector, a one-dimensional thing, and a matrix, a two-dimensional thing, are modeled with the same data type, namely the array. But then if I call dot shape on the matrix, I get a tuple of two elements because the, because the matrix has two dimensions, that's why. And the first dimension is the rows. So we have three rows in the matrix, and the second dimension is the columns, and here we have three columns as well. Our own version of the matrix has two properties called n rows and n columns. So here the usage is different, but we can also create a tuple if we want. Note how we don't have an attribute on our vector because we don't really need an attribute on our own vector because we have we can always use the built-in len function on our vector and also get the number. Saying that, let's use the built-in len function. Now call it with NumPy array. The NumPy array y gives us back three because there are three components in the array, three components in the vector. If you call it for our own implementation of a vector, we also get back a three. So in this case, our own implementation works just as NumPy. And now let's do that for the matrix. Now if I call the len built-in on the x array, what do I get back? I should get back, what should I get back? I have a 3x3 matrix, so nine entries in the matrix, but I get back three. Why? Well, because for a two-dimensional array, NumPy, the length of an array, defaults to the number of rows. So three here means three rows. But if I call len for our own matrix, we get back nine. So it really depends on what we want. I think our implementation is a bit more intuitive because the length of a matrix should be the number of entries in it. Can we call transpose? Yes. NumPy also has a dot transpose method. So this is the transposition of the matrix. We can, of course, also use our own transpose method. We get the same result. First row is always 147. So in that way, we are similar. And now let's do matrix vector multiplication. How do we do that in NumPy? I don't like that here, we have to use the dot method on the X array and then give as the first argument the Y array. This is now this is matrix vector multiplication. What happens if I write X array times Y array? I, funny enough, get back a 3x3 thing. That's weird. So multiplying a 3x3 matrix by a vector of size 3, I should get back a vector of three components. So what happens here is really broadcasting. So broadcasting in NumPy also works not only for scalars, but also if I, so the vector gets broadcasted up to the matrix, and then the two matrices get multiplied on a per element basis. So from a linear algebra point of view, this operation does not make any sense. However, if I multiply our own version of matrix with vector, we get back a vector. So in this regard, our own version of matrix vector may be a little bit nicer to look at. However, in newer versions of Python, there is a new operator, namely the add, and the add does also the dot product. So the upper row is NumPy's way of saying matrix times vector, and the star operator, the multiplication operator, does something else in NumPy, and we defined our own operator to do matrix vector multiplication according to the rules of linear algebra. And if we wanted to overload the add operator here, we would just overload not the mul special method, but the matmul special method, because the add operator here is called the matrix multiplication operator. It's quite new in Python, but not so many people use it. It's kind of weird to look at, but I think it's a good operator still. Then we can, of course, do scalar multiplication. So 10 times the vector gives me a new vector, 10, 12, 30. So that works for NumPy. We have seen that I can do scalar multiplication for our own version of vectors as well. And then now comes the weird part. I can add NumPy's vector with our vector. And why does that work? Why can I add two data types that definitely don't know about each other? So NumPy knows about many data types, but it definitely does not know about our vector data type that we just wrote here in this chapter. And in our own vector, we did not look at NumPy. So how come that Python magically knows how to add two things that don't know about each other's type? How this works is because, as we learned, in Python, it's only the behavior of an object that matters. And NumPy, the NumPy developers, they were so smart that they, in their own implementation of their thunderAdd special method, at a very last resort, what they do is they check if they can loop over the other object. And of course, if the other object is finite and of the same length. But we saw that the length built-in gives back 3 for the NumPy's array here and also 3 for our own vector. So the length is the same. And then what NumPy smartly does in the background is it simply loops over our vector. And only because we implemented our own vectors to be a sequence, to behave like a sequence by being iterable, this is why this works. And this is a very beautiful example of why, A, we have to only think of objects in Python in terms of their behavior. It doesn't matter what type something is. We only care about the behavior. And it also pays off to always implement the standard behaviors that Python offers, most notably the sequence behavior. Whenever we build a new, or whenever we create a new data type in our own custom application, so whenever we teach Python some new semantics about the world, we should always think of making this class a sequence. How do we do that? Well, as we saw, all we need to do is to include a dunder-len and a dunder-get-item method. That's it. And then Python can figure out the looping. Alternatively, we can implement the dunder-iter method. But it doesn't matter. If we design our own classes to be a sequence, then they interact seamlessly with loads and lots and lots of other data types that they have never heard about, just because the behavior matters. Okay, so let's see that what I'm telling you actually works. I can add the two vectors, even though they are totally different data types. Can I multiply them? Let's check. Also works. Interesting. So who is responsible for the multiplication here is, of course, also the NumPy array. And the NumPy array, by default, does multiplication on a per element wise fashion. This is why the vector 1, 2, 3 and both y array and y vec are both vectors 1, 2, 3. This is why they are multiplied component wise. This is why we see 1, 4, 9. So mathematically, this cell doesn't make any sense, but it works. And it does make sense in the context of NumPy, because NumPy really doesn't model linear algebra first. It models something else first, namely the array idea. Can I add the two matrices? Well, let's think before I execute this. Why could I add the two vectors in the first cell? Well, because NumPy tried to loop over our vector, and it could. Now, guess what? The X array also tries to loop over our X mat. However, we have seen by using the built-in len function that when I call len with X array, I get back 3, because the only thing len gives back is the number of rows in something. When I call len on our X mat, however, we return 9. For the number of entries in the matrix. And because of that, because the sizes don't match, NumPy does not know how to deal with that. That's why I get a value error here. Okay, so this was the last slide in this presentation. So I know that there is some more stuff to be discovered when you read this chapter. And so let me repeat a little bit what we learned today. So this chapter put everything together, and by everything I mean everything. So all the behaviors, all the the memory diagrams that I drew, and where I explained to you how something works in Python, all of this behavior can be customized by knowing which of the special methods we have to implement, and then we can make Python work with our object in a very seamless way. In other words, we can always build custom data types that can fit seamlessly into the standard Python syntax. But what this chapter is actually mainly about is about giving semantics to code. So we started with the example of multiplying a tuple times a list of lists, and Python returned raised a type error. And now, at the end of the day, our own vector and our own matrix class, they are nothing but a tuple and a list of lists that learned how to multiply each other. So we taught Python linear algebra here. And whatever the domain is that you model, you can teach Python about whatever your problem is that you're modeling in the same way. Here's just the linear algebra that we used as an example. But any application that gets a little bit bigger, you would use the same ideas to organize your code. So this chapter is really about giving semantics to code. But this chapter is also about more. It's also about reusing code. So why do we reuse code? Well, we see that classes are nothing but blueprints that that contain all the behaviors, all the functionalities that data types or the objects that are of this data type can have. So we can have as many vectors as we want, and they all behave in the same way. This could be also a concrete instance of an int, and this could be the int blueprint. That's Python built-ins. But now we have figured out a way of how we can do the same thing for custom classes, for custom blueprints. And it has a lot to do with reuse of code, because every time we create a new vector object, all we store in the concrete instances is, as we can see, we only store data in it, right? And usually the saying goes that data and behavior usually goes to an object is, basically organizing the data and the behavior that go with the data. And what we mean by organizing, the object-oriented paradigm means that we put all the behavior in one box or in one group of boxes and all the data in other group of boxes. So here we have data on the left and we have the behavior on the right, and it's all perfectly separated. And this is what you should aim at in coding. And that's what we learned. And I hope that you also learned a little bit of math. And if you get bored after this course, continue with Gilbert Strang's linear algebra course. And he also, I showed you in the beginning his original course, the basic linear algebra course, but he also has a new course that was published last year. And in this new course, he teaches the fundamentals of linear algebra when in the context of data science. So this is also an interesting course. You can really learn a lot from Gilbert. And here, again, this chapter, I think, puts together everything from this course. It's kind of like the final chapter that after which you, if you get this, you get everything. But I think the important idea is now you should go back and study this course from the beginning on, because now you know where everything you read about in the first 9 chapters will lead to. And I think understanding chapter 10 and then starting to go over the book again from chapter 1, 2, and so on, basically, helps you to see the details then. When you read the book the second time and you know what is the big idea where we are aiming at, that will enable you to really understand the details and get good at it. And you should repeat stuff anyways. I'm pretty sure no one can, be good at this coding after only going through the course once, because the density of the materials in this course is quite high. But again, keep the big idea in mind, go back, do it again, and I think the second time around, many, many things will make a lot more sense, many of the things that you didn't get the first time around. And then after you go back and have redone chapters 1 through 10 and reviewed, you're really good at the foundations of Python, then you will go on in the chapters after 10, where we look at individual details and applications of Python, okay? So this is the basic course in Python. I hope to see you soon again, then for an add-on of this course, which will probably be chapter 11, and also for other courses maybe. See you soon.